Welcome to this live edition of the InfoWars Nightly News. I'm David Knight with Jakari Jackson, and as they say, it ain't over till the fat lady in the pantsuit sings. And
That's the abridged version.
That's right. I think tonight we're going to hear her singing something like, if you remember Young Frankenstein, Oh Sweet Mystery of Life, At Last I Found You. It looks like this is going to be the night that it puts it over for Hillary, but of course it looks like she put one over on everybody earlier today by having the AP announce that she was already the winner.
Yes, I saw that.
Yeah. And of course there's been some people have gone back and uncovered some graphics that have been put out there and say, hey, well, was this a plot or whatever? Look, here's the situation where we come in tonight. We've got Hillary ahead and pledged delegates at 54%, and we're going to be right back in just a moment.
Talk about leveling with the American people. Have you always told the truth?
I've always tried to.
You know, is she in it for us or is she in it for herself?
What difference at this point does it make?
Donald Trump has already sealed the deal for the Republican nomination, but will Bernie's wrecking crew be out in full force to tear the roof off when Clinton's camp steals California?
You know,
excuse me, I'm talking.
Let him sprung.
Join me and the rest of the InfoWars crew this Tuesday, June 7th at 7 p.m. We're going to be going live to document Hillary's last stand.
I don't feel no ways tired. I come too far.
So you ask my opinion, I will tell you my opinion. I'm not going to be channeling my husband.
Join us live this Super Tuesday at 7 p.m. Central for the InfoWars Nightly News.
Welcome back to our live coverage of the InfoWars Nightly News presidential primaries. Of course, this is the end of the road, isn't it, Jakari? And as you just saw with that graphic, we've got primary results that are going to be coming in from across the country, from New Jersey all the way to California. And yes, we've got reporters on location, all these areas too, don't we?
Absolutely. We have Joe Biggs out there triggering Bernie supporters in California. Also, Leanne McAdoo is going to have some reports from Hillary Clinton events. We have Richard Reeves in the New York, New Jersey area. He's going to give us the results up there. Also, Kit Daniels is in studio with us. He's over there in Studio B. And, of course, we'll have some reports from Rob Dew, Paul Joseph Watson, as they document their trip to Bilderberg.
That's right. And we're going to have a press event from Donald Trump that's going to happen at 10 o'clock Central Time. And that's going to be about the time we get the returns in from California. Here are the states that are coming in tonight. First, we're going to have New Jersey, and they've just closed the polls in New Jersey. That has 126 delegates. Next to California, that's the largest number of delegates we've got for the night. And then after that, we're going to have results from New Mexico, South Dakota, and North Dakota. And that's going to be in 1 hour at 8 p.m. The polls will close there. Then we go to Montana, the next time zone, and that's going to be closing at 9 o'clock Central Time. And then California, which will be at 10 o'clock Central. That's when the polls are going to close in California, and that's when we're going to have the Donald Trump press conference. And, of course, there's probably going to be a lot of talk about all the back-and-forth accusations of racism, charges surrounding the what Donald Trump said about the judge being biased against him and the Trump University case. I think he's got a strong point there. We're going to talk about that in just a moment. But first, tonight, with Hillary and Bernie Sanders in California, as I was pointing out in the introduction, where it stands right now, Hillary is at 54% of the pledged delegates or the earned delegates or the delegates that she got from the primaries. Mm-hmm. And Bernie is at 46%. I think, Jakari, that his only real chance of taking this into a brokered convention, and he's saying that he's not going to get out even after tonight, win or lose. I think his only chance at a brokered convention is if he could somehow get a plurality of the delegates from the voting. Otherwise, Hillary Clinton says, hey, look, I've got a million more votes than you do, or, you know, 2 million or whatever it is.
Superdelegates.
And so, you know, yeah, taking the superdelegates out, you know, he would have to do more than she had. In other words, the difference would be that the superdelegates would be reversing the reported popular vote. I think that's the only chance that he's got. And I don't see that happening. I mean, he's not even winning in the popular vote. He has in the most recent states.
Yes.
But he was losing in the early states pretty badly. So right now it stands at 54 to 46%. not counting the superdelegates. If you put the superdelegates in, AP tells us earlier today that she won the election because we had, what was it, Puerto Rico? My wife heard that. She says, wait a minute, Puerto Rico is not a state. What are they doing voting in the election? Good question. Good question. Well, they're trying to get bailed out, I think, is what it is.
Well, when you talk about Bernie Sanders and Mrs. Clinton, they've been going at it for a while now. And it's even to the point, you know, we're not Bernie Sanders supporters. At least I know I'm not. I'm sure you're not either. But it's to the point now where they're saying that Bernie should just exit out of the campaign altogether because he's becoming a sexist for merely remaining in the race. And this is what they're teaching the kids now.
Yeah.
You know, because we brought you that article last week about the kid, I believe he was up in Plano, up around the Dallas area. They said you can't wear your National Honor Society banner because it makes the other kids feel bad. Mr. Sanders, you can no longer be in this race because you're hurting the chances of the first woman president, and it's sexist for you to do so.
That's the insanity we've created in this country. And, of course, the person who asked that question was a New York Times reporter.
Yes.
You know, this prestigious paper of record.
And Mr. Sanders, Bernie Sanders, he's like, are you serious? Is this a real question?
Is this a serious question? He said, yeah. And he goes, so you're saying then that as a male, I can't challenge somebody if there's a female that's running. And I mean, that's the absurd level of stupidity that we've gotten
on anything.
Now.
If they would have said back in the last election, Mitt Romney, you're a racist because you continue to run against Barack Obama. I said, that's ridiculous. That's absurd on its face.
Except we have heard people say that you're racist if you criticize Barack Obama. Right. That has been the situation throughout the entire Obama presidency, that he is off limits to question him. It's off limits to question his Muslim upbringing. And we know that he was brought up in Indonesia, which is a Muslim country. He spent a good deal of time in a Muslim school. And even more interesting is the fact that his father worked for, was a high official in that government, which we haven't heard much about in the United States, but you went to that movie, The Act of Killing, right? Which showed these guys confessing to the mass government murders of people, saying, yeah, we found out the best thing we could do is tie a wire over here to this hand railing, put these people here, and then wrap it around their necks and choke them to death or cut their heads off. They were bragging about that.
Yeah.
And that's the criminal regime that the CIA helped to set up there. And, of course, the father who raised him, Sotero, as well, you know, was a part of that regime. And then his mother was a part of the CIA. So is that not a relevant question? But we're not allowed to ask those types of questions because, you know, we have to embrace people who are from outside of America more than we do people who are inside.
Well, a similar thing when you talk about the actions of Bill Clinton. If you bring up all the women in his past, I'm not even talking about Monica, but the other women, you're just anti-Hillary. You just don't want to see a woman be president. You're sexist.
That's right. That's right. And that's the other issue, too. I think Bernie perhaps may be thinking that he needs to stay in this, even if he can't make the case that he got more popular votes than and Hillary did, so the superdelegates need to not be the balance of power, not reverse the votes. Even if that doesn't happen, perhaps he thinks that he can stay in case Hillary is indicted. But even if that happens, do you really think that's going to matter? Because, I mean, Bill Clinton was not only indicted for perjury, and it wasn't for infidelity, it wasn't for cheating on his wife. Bill Clinton, a lawyer, a president, was indicted for lying under oath.
Absolutely.
He knew better than that. It had consequences for him as a lawyer. But he was impeached for that as well as indicted. So if the Democrats, and then, Democrats didn't have any problem with that. So I don't think they're going to have any problem with Hillary being indicted.
No, the FBI is only going after Hillary because they're sexist.
That's right. That's right. And we know that for a fact, don't we? Well, you know, there's an interesting story, Jakari, as we're looking at how they're coming after Donald Trump for the racism thing. And of course, the most devastating shoe has now fallen. We see Jeb Bush calling on Donald Trump to retract his statements because he is obviously racist, and Jeb Bush knows a racist when he sees one.
Oh, not Jeb Bush. Oh, not Jeb Bush.
Yeah. And then we've got Paul Ryan, you know, who was so reluctant to throw his hat behind Donald Trump. And let's get this clip up where Paul Ryan talks about Donald Trump as being a textbook racist. Let's play that if we got that ready. Maybe we don't.
I disavow these requirements. I regret those comments that he made. I don't think claiming a person can't do their job because of their race is sort of like the textbook definition of a racist comment. I think that should be absolutely disavowed. It's absolutely unacceptable. But do I believe that Hillary Clinton is the answer? No, I do not. Do I believe that Hillary Clinton is going to be the answer to solving these problems? I do not.
Okay, but when you call him a racist, you can't have it both ways, Paul. You know, you can either You can either be with her, okay, or you can be with him. I mean, that's it may be Hobson's choice, but it's the only choice you've got. And his real choice, Jakari, of course, is that he wants open borders. We know that. We've seen that over and over again. He's been at the forefront of introducing legislation, even as a Republican, for open borders. He wants the trade treaties. Mm-hmm. He is a full-on establishment globalist. And it doesn't matter whether he's an R or a D, okay? He is closer on this vital issue. And, of course, we're going to be talking, having some reports from our reporters. We won't be talking to them live, but we'll have some reports that our reporters have filed from Bilderberg. He is a full-on globalist. And in that respect, he has far more in common with Hillary Clinton than he does with Donald Trump, because this
Absolutely.
Election is truly about nationalism versus globalism. But when he goes in and he says, you're going to question his Mexican heritage here and say that he's biased, it completely misrepresents both what Donald Trump said and what the situation is. And for days, we've been saying, what's the matter with everybody? Why can't they identify the fact that this is a La Raza judge, that he identifies and thinks that Hispanics should be empowered? We should have more lawyers who are Hispanic simply because they're Hispanic. He's not there trying to get more lawyers who are white or who are black or who are Indian. He wants more Hispanic judges. And of course, La Raza means the race. And there was a great flashback that was put up on the Drudge Report talking about when Sotomayor was going through a confirmation hearings. And they said, well, unlike Ruth Bader Ginsburg and Sandra Day O'Connor, who both said, look, yeah, we're women, but a wise old man and a wise old woman would reach the same decision on cases. It's not a matter of our sex. And yet when Sotomayor was up, she made this famous quote about the wise Latina woman. Remember this? I would hope that a wise Latina woman with the richness of her experiences would more often than not reach a better conclusion than a white male who hasn't lived that life. So it was not only an issue for her, but it was one of the things that made her more qualified than, let's say, a white male. Okay. So how do you have it both ways? Quite frankly, I am sick to death of this double standard. And we know exactly what is behind all these establishment Republicans. So we got Paul Ryan, that you just heard there. We got Lindsey Graham, who, by the way, as Rob Dew pointed out earlier today, is going to be at the Bilderberg meeting in Germany, in Dresden, where they're reporting from. And as Rob Dew said, hey, how about the Logan Act, which prohibits that type of thing?
These guys are going over there.
Yeah, exactly. And we got Joe Scarborough saying, the GOP needs to back away from Trump. He says, make him back down on this racist comment that he's made about a man who's born in Indiana. Well, that's not the issue. Being born in Indiana is not the issue. And he's a second generation person who's come in here. And I think, Jakari, that a lot of people who were born, their parents came in from another country, whether it's they're Hispanic or whether they're Muslim or whatever, I think it's the second generation that is trying to establish their own identity apart from being American. And especially if the guy doesn't physically look any different than a white man, he wants to say, I'm not part of that white privilege, because that is such an albatross around your neck in a university situation. So they're desperate to establish a different identity. They want to be a hyphenated American. And so they get more racist than their parents, who understood what they were coming from, and they don't have this idealized version of Mexico.
This issue of white privilege isn't even definitively defined, because when I went out to Albuquerque and I was talking to the people out there, and they said, we don't like Trump. And I know you can like Trump or dislike Trump for whatever reasons you like, but they said, we don't like him because he has white privilege. I was like, well, Bernie's white too. Well, Bernie's different. Bernie's one of us. Like,
yeah. Technically, he's Jewish, and they make a distinction with that as well. So, you know, we had this article from Kurt Nimmo, and we're talking about how they idealize their heritage, okay, to try to set up their own ethnic identity, because that is so highly valued in the educational circles that they're going to travel in, and these liberal circles that they're going to travel in. So we had this article from Kurt Nimmo today at Infowars.com, Make America Mexico Again, because we've seen those signs.
I've actually seen those when we go out to Anaheim and Albuquerque.
Don't make it great. Just make it Mexico again. Do we really want it to be like Mexico?
Why are people leaving Mexico?
Exactly. Here's why people are leaving Mexico, and Kurt's got this in his article. If America becomes Mexico again, this is what it would look like. The median poverty rate would be 46%. Okay, the poverty rate would be 76%. The Americans would categorized as poor would earn $157 a month. The middle class would have a quarterly income of between $2,000 and $4,000. In other words, every 3 months you would make $2,000 to $4,000. Do we really want to get romanticized about Mexico? And do we really want to reproduce this? As we were talking about our experiences growing up, when I was in Florida, we had people who would come there from New York. And they would say, hey, we left New York. The cost of living was so high. And then you would have a bond issue that would come up. And it's like, I'll vote for that because, you know, taxes are so low here. And it's like, how do you think the cost of living got unaffordable in New York?
The same thing. And we were talking about people coming to Texas from California.
Yeah.
And they leave California, like I said, taxes or whatever issue. And then they come here and they want to vote for the exact same type of government they had in California that forced them out of them in the first place.
And what they're doing with the open borders, especially focusing on young people, offering them free tuition. And of course, we had the article today as well as the experiences that Hillary Clinton is going around with college students, one of them from Korea, saying, hey, you know, she's getting a free ride. Isn't this wonderful? She's getting a free ride at taxpayer expenses. And then we've got an article that goes down and shows all the tweets of people who are getting $300,000 in a full ride scholarship tuition and saying, isn't this great? I got this because I am an illegal. And so they give me extra special benefits here. So they're selling this. She wants to bring in reliable minions who will soon become registered voters. There's that story right there, bragging about $300,000 scholarships on Twitter. And if you go through that article, there's example after example after example of these tweets that people have put out talking about how much they're ripping off the American taxpayer for. How do we continue to do this, Jakari? I mean,
it's not sustainable to give $300,000 to anybody.
And those are some of the more expensive universities. I mean, the South Korean girl went to Azusa Pacific, I think is the name of the college, in California. Her tuition was only $177,000. Oh. But it was 35, just for the tuition alone, it was five times what they pay on average in South Korea. It was $35,500. And of course, if you do the full ride scholarship, it came up to about $44,500. But looking at that, and Korea is $7,000, and the Korean students are saying, hey, this doesn't make any sense. And of course, it doesn't make any sense to go into debt that much for those degrees. So they come to America where they can get it for free. Stay with us. We're going to be right back, and we're going to be talking to our reporters on location from New Jersey to California, as well as reports from Germany. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the InfoWars Nightly News live coverage of the presidential primaries. And, of course, we have primaries that are running from New Jersey to California. So we're going to be here for the next 4 hours as the polls close and the election results come in. Also at 10 o'clock Central, we're going to have as the polls close in California, Donald Trump is going to have a press conference in the East Coast. So we're going to be bringing you the results of that. As that comes in, I'm here with Jakari Jackson. Of course, we have our reporters. Richard Reeves is in New Jersey. We've got Leanne McAdoo and Joe Biggs in California. And we're going to have some reports from Rob Dew, who is in Bilderberg right now. So we're all over the world here right now, Jakari. And we sure do appreciate your support. We wouldn't be able to do it without those of you who are listeners to the nightly news broadcast, those of you who subscribe to the Prison Planet TV, as well as those of you who buy the products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, we were just talking about this back and forth and all the friendly fire and so-called friendly fire that Donald Trump is getting. You know, we had Newt Gingrich, who came out and said a lot of nice things about
Donald
Trump.
That was very strange. Did you think that was strange?
Yeah.
Or was it just me? Because I remember, of all people, I just thought this in my head. I was like, why is Newt Gingrich cheerleading for Donald Trump?
That worried a lot of us because, you know, as well as I do and our listeners know, that Newt Gingrich is a dyed-in-the-wool neocon globalist. And so when Newt Gingrich was getting real friendly with Donald Trump, that kind of worried us. And when I heard him dump on Trump about this comment about the judge being a member of La Raza, and of course, he should have said that instead of just saying, well, because of his
heritage.
Mexican heritage and so forth, which is very important to him. That's why he's a member of La Raza. I wish that Trump had stated that more clearly. But when he did that, Newt Gingrich said this. Actually, that's Donald Trump coming back with that. So we got a clip of Newt Gingrich. Let's get that pulled up. I can tell you what he said. He said that what Donald Trump did was inappropriate. And when I heard that, you know, I guess Trump is saying a two Newt. You know, when you want to stab somebody in the back, you got to first get behind him.
Okay? Yeah, yeah.
And that's what Newt Gingrich did, and got behind him, and then had those comments about him, and then Trump now has pushed back against Gingrich. When I heard this on Sunday, I said, well, I think that's actually a good sign, because yes. I think that Gingrich was kind of rebuffed when he was talking to Donald Trump. I believe that they didn't get what they wanted out of him, and now we've got some more information about that. But let's play that clip if we got that ready now. Do we not have any audio on
that?
Yeah. Okay. I'm not hearing the audio on that. Is that coming through? Okay. I think we got we got a problem with that clip. So,
in the meantime, while they're working on that, we have this article from Kit Daniels, and it's a report talking about how Trump refused $200 million to pick Gingrich as his VP. So we know when he was making all those nice statements, maybe he was jockeying for that VP spot, Newt Gingrich. And it says the mainstream media reported that the casino magnate Sheldon Adelson was willing to contribute $100 million to Trump's campaign, but wasn't reported was the extra $100 million the establishment offered Trump in exchange for picking Gingrich. So
yeah,
he had a very lucrative offer.
And that's precisely what I was kind of thinking had happened. You know, I just thought, well, it looks like maybe this isn't working out for the Gingrich globalists. And then we get this report that Kit Daniels did the article on. And of course, Newt Gingrich got $100 million pledge from Sheldon Adelson. And that was 4 years ago when Newt was running. And then Newt didn't go too far in the primaries, and he only got about $10 million of that, and most of that was returned back to Sheldon Adelson. Mm-hmm. And so when I saw Sheldon Adelson come in and pony up with $100 million, I thought, that's kind of bad. When I saw Newt Gingrich come in, I thought, that's also kind of bad.
Oh, yeah.
But we got the backstory here to this. I think it's kind of good, and I think what we continue to see is that Trump is going to call it the way he wants, and he's going to do what he thinks is right. He has been authentic, I think, on this trade issue, the way the U.S. has been taken advantage of with NAFTA, also the way we're going to be taken advantage of with the Trans-Pacific, Transatlantic, quote-unquote, partnerships. Mm-hmm. All of these are trade treaties. They can call them trade agreements. They can call them partnerships, but they are treaties. And already we've seen the Republicans, as well as the Democrats, shut down the constitutional process for ratification, just thumbing their nose at it. The only person who stood up against this was Jeff Sessions. And I hope he's the person that gets picked as vice president by Donald Trump. He's been advising Donald Trump on the details of the Trans-Pacific and the Transatlantic treaties. And he tried to advise Congress on it. They had the opportunity to go look at it finally. It was negotiated for years in secret by corporate lawyers and lobbyists, and our elected representatives couldn't see it. When it was finally made available, only one person, Jeff Sessions, bothered to go down and see it. And he was so disturbed by what he saw on so many different levels, not only the way that we're going to be screwed by trade agreements, but also by the loss of sovereignty. Our economy will be managed by a committee that we have absolutely no control over. Mm-hmm. These agreements, as complicated as they are, 4,000 or 5,000 pages each, they don't mean anything because it will be a living agreement. This committee will be able to change this at will once this is created. And of course, it has aspects aspects of our life are going to be affected by this. It's going to affect immigration. It's also going to affect internet freedom. It's so many different issues.
And it reminds me of that video. I believe Zimmerman shot it at one of these Trump rallies, and he had this Trump supporter, this lady had on the Trump hat, and she was trying to explain to some young lady out there why we need to have jobs here in America. Mm-hmm. She's like, all our jobs are in China. They're in Mexico. And then the girl said, well, what are the people in Mexico and China going to do if we bring the jobs back here? And we're like, well,
they have their own economy.
Yeah, they have their own issues.
If they get the government out of the way in China and some of these other places, they could have a prosperous and a free economy there as well. So that's really what needs to happen. Of course, the thing I was amazed at, Jakari, and of course, one of the people dumping on Trump, as you would expect, would be Gary Johnson, who is doing everything he can to cozy up to the Democrats, mm-hmm. always criticizing Trump, saying he's clearly a racist. And yet,
I've been really disappointed in the Libertarian Party. You know, I was a big fan of John McAfee. Unfortunately, he didn't get the nomination, but Whether it's the striptease guy or some of these more recent comments made by Johnson, I'm just not a big fan right now.
Well, when you look at, he's betrayed the Libertarian Party on many important principles, especially guns. We're going to talk about that in just a moment, what's happening with guns, especially in California. But on the issue of free trade, as they call it, and of course, this is not free trade. This is managed trade, and that's the underlying fallacy that they don't want to embrace. And the other aspect of it is with open borders and a welfare state, it's going to bankrupt you. We just talked about what will happen with just college students alone. If they were to bring in the 3.3 million college students and just send them to Azusa Pacific, that would be a $600 billion bill for us for all the South Korean students. And why wouldn't we let all the South Korean students come?
And that's the issue, David. Even if we were going to pay for everybody's school, why do we have to send them to one of the most expensive schools out there? What's wrong with community college if it's that big of a deal?
Joe Jennings just came in here during the break, and he said he's from California. He said, oh, by the way, Azusa Pacific is a very expensive private Christian college. And I'm thinking, wow, does Hillary know that? I mean, wouldn't you think that she would recoil at the idea that...
Christians.
But see, if they're illegal immigrants, that trumps everything, okay? That makes everything okay. I mean, it isn't the separation of church and state. She's not worried about that. She's not worried about the fact this girl is going to a Christian college. It's very expensive. As long as she's here illegally, and as long as she sees Hillary as her benefactor, not the U.S. taxpayers, they're bad. Okay, but Hillary is her benefactor, and that's the important thing, is to see that so that she can become their minion. You know, we're looking at what's going on with La Raza, and we're looking at these trade agreements. Remember that it was just last week that we had one of the Castro twins, and I'll explain who they are in just a moment, one of the Castro twins touring with Obama to promote the Trans-Pacific Partnership. They were in Vietnam. And who are the Castro twins? Well, people who are here in Texas know who they are. We've got the former mayor of San Antonio and his brother. His brother is a congressman. He was the one who was touring with Obama. And, of course, Obama and this Castro congressman had betrayed the Democrat voters who don't like these trade deals. Hillary is saying she's not for the trade deal, even though Obama is, and he's got some Democrats who are. And, of course, Bernie says he's against it. But Hillary is talking about the other Castro brother, the one who went on to become the HUD secretary. He was the former mayor of San Antonio. He is one of the leading vice presidential picks for Hillary Clinton. So you know she's going to support that. We'll be right back.
A lot of people ask me, what is the most important area of InfoWars that runs the whole operation that is having such a big effect against the globalists? And I've said it over and over again, it is you, the listeners and the viewers, that send us the intel, the news tips, that support the broadcast, that spread the word. You are 90% of the operation or more. You don't stand beside us. You stand at the heart of InfoWars. When I talk about the people at InfoWars, from customer service, the shipping department, being just as important as our anchors, our researchers, our investigative journalists, and myself, it's absolutely true. Without this team that we've built over the last 20 plus years, we wouldn't be able to do any of what we've been doing. And that's what's so exciting, because we finally built up to a point where we now have the launch pad. Introducing AutoShip for InfoWarsLife.com, a new way to save time and money when you stock up on InfoWarsStore.com products. Again, ladies and gentlemen, when products are sold out, you're unable to get them, sometimes for months, but we hold back the products for people that have already signed up for AutoShip. When you choose AutoShip before checkout on your order at InfoWarsStore.com, we'll give you 10% off and give you guaranteed delivery of out-of-stock products that are on your AutoShip list. Plus, we're giving you free shipping on all orders above $50. Listeners have been requesting this for years because it's so easy to forget to reorder the products when you need them each month. Now it's finally here. AutoShip at InfoWarsStore.com and InfoWarsLife.com. It's easy. Go to InfoWarsStore.com, select your favorite product, click on the AutoShip, and choose how often you want us to send you another order. As you know, I coined the term 360 win, and with the new AutoShip feature at InfoWarsLife.com, it's a sure win. You add to that free shipping on orders of $50, it is a can't lose. Visit InfoWarsStore.com and save 10% off on your next InfoWars Life order by selecting AutoShip at checkout, and get free shipping on all orders above $50. That's InfoWarsStore.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139.
You Your liver can be full of fatty deposits, built-up toxins, and even dangerous objects known as liver stones. We worked with the top developers in the field of detox to take tried and true herbs and other compounds known to safely cleanse the liver and fused it with the latest research and technological development on concentrating these ingredients to give you the maximum effect. Liver Shield is the only liver support product on the market that uses a patented Spigerex blend of powerful organic herbs that support detoxification. And when you visit InfoWarsLife.com, see the instructional video on how to do a six-day liver detox. This isn't a game, and let me tell you, the results are dramatic. Liver Shield is totally organic and made of the safest high-quality herbs. Liver Shield is the only liver support product on the market that uses a patented Spigerex blend of powerful organic herbs that support detoxification. And when you visit InfoWarsLife.com, see the instructional video on how to do a six-day liver detox. This isn't a game, and let me tell you, the results are dramatic. Liver Shield is totally organic and made of the safest high-quality herbs. But that said, you need to consult your physician before you do the full detox. Liver Shield can also be used daily by itself for overall upkeep of the liver. Secure your Liver Shield today exclusively at InfoWarsLife.com for the lowest price available. That's InfoWarsLife.com or call 888-253-3139.
To the InfoWars Nightly News, live coverage of the final set of presidential primaries. Of course, we're going to have six of them tonight from New Jersey to California. We've got reporters from New Jersey to California that are going to be joining us with live reports. We have Donald Trump, who's going to be holding a press conference at 10 p.m. Central Time. That's the time that the last polls in California close. But of course, it's interesting, Jakari, that 2383, the number that was needed for the Democratic nomination, that was what AP gave to Hillary Clinton today. Mm-hmm. Not one vote less, not one vote
more. It's like a hole in one, David.
That's right. Isn't it convenient? You know, just tell the Bernie Sanders voters, don't bother to go to the polls. It's all over, folks. Mm-hmm. You know, the fat lady in the pantsuit is a song now.
Okay. He's a singing.
That's right. As we're talking about this whole thing with La Raza, and I was just mentioning before we went to break the Castro twins, significant because one of them has been touted as vice presidential material. He even said, hey, I'm brushing up on my Spanish. It's like, so he's not really authentically Hispanic, I guess. They were raised in the United States, but they were raised by a La Raza mama. Their mama was one of the founders of La Raza in this area. And she's worked very hard in this. She's worked to make her sons very political. And they've been very successful, going from the mayor of San Antonio to the head of HUD, one of those agencies that ought to be eliminated. Okay, but then her other son becoming a congressman and touring Vietnam with Obama to promote these globalist trade treaties. And so even though Hillary Clinton supported TPP earlier, she now says she doesn't support it. But she's looking very closely and an Hispanic HUD secretary who does support this along with Obama. And so this is what we're seeing with this. This is all part of the globalist movement that they're bringing in here, Jakari.
Absolutely, absolutely. And these type of things can't be ignored. I remember hearing about this guy back when he was the mayor of San Antonio. I think I even tried to interview him once. It didn't work out too well.
Yeah. Well, he wants to get rid of the Alamo, that's for sure. He doesn't, that's a real stench to him. He doesn't realize that there were a lot of Hispanic people who fought at the Alamo because they didn't want to be under the tyranny of Santa Anna. A lot of them died there, okay, mm-hmm. and all over the place. As a matter of fact, when Santa Anna, who was known for his tyranny, became the dictator of Mexico, essentially every Mexican province went into revolt. Only three of them lasted for very long, and the other two were conquered. Only Texas made it out. But it wasn't an English versus Hispanic struggle, as they like to portray it now. See, that's the way they reinvent this stuff. That's the way this judge who is in the Trump case is. You know, they come back and they want to reinvent their Mexican heritage, create something that they can be proud of, give themselves a special, unique identity, and they want to make it about some kind of a racial division. That's why, you know, Obama has been the most divisive president we've ever had. And so now we see this in these subsequent generations of Hispanics. They don't understand. It was a fight against tyranny, and it was a fight against tyranny that both English and Latinos stood together shoulder to shoulder to fight this tyrant. They didn't care whether he spoke Spanish or not. They just didn't want to be under Santa Ana. But that's not the way the Castros like to play this.
And that's a very good point what you make there, David, is for so many people, it's a racial issue. I'm not just talking about with Santa Ana, but just with any person, you know, any power. So oftentimes they try to make it a racial issue, a religious issue, or whatever type of issue, when it's not. It's just people came together, they saw a common threat, whatever that threat may have been at the time, and they joined forces to combat that.
That's right. We're going to have a report from Roger Stone and Alex Jones where they talked in detail about the particular Trump University case, also a parallel case that the media is very carefully avoiding talking about that involves Hillary Clinton. We're going to have that later in the broadcast. But for the moment, I wanted to talk a little bit about some brave new schools information here, Jakari. There's a couple of articles, one of them from the Daily Caller, talking about how a high school boy wins all-state honors in Alaska. Now, he says that even though he's a male, he says he identifies as being a female. And so he gets to compete in all the track events against women. And he is sweeping all of the events. And they're saying, that's not fair. That's not fair.
Well, in the brave new world, that's fair. Because we live in a world now, David, where a man can win Woman of the Year, Sportswoman of the Year with Caitlyn Jenner. I was surprised more women weren't outraged about that.
Yeah. I mean, you know, he did pretty good in the Olympics. Just imagine if Bruce Jenner had competed as a woman. You know, he could have probably even competed in things that weren't his event and won because he was in pretty good shape. But this is the way they responded in Alaska. One of the students there said, well, I'm glad this person is comfortable with who they are and that they're able to be happy in who they are. But I don't think it's competitively completely 100% fair. It's not really fair. And then another one says, well, I don't know what's politically correct to say, but in my opinion, your gender is what you're born with. And then another one says, it's the DNA. Genetically, a guy has more muscle mass than a girl, and if he's racing against a girl, he may have an advantage. Oh, you think? You think? I mean, this is where they're coming. But let's not let common sense stand in the way of Massachusetts. It would never get in the way of Massachusetts. We got an article here from the Conservative Review. The Massachusetts House overwhelmingly passed a bill to abolish biological sex. And this is a 116-36 vote in the House of Representatives in Massachusetts. They're moving forward with a bill that legally replaces the concept of biological sex with that of gender identity. And this, of course, is all part of the manufactured controversy over transgendered bathrooms.
And David,
we've had bathrooms forever, okay, that it wasn't a problem. And a transgender person, as I've had a caller call in and point out, a real transgender person wants to be able to pass as that sex. I mean, if it's a guy who is really into this, he wants people to think that he's a woman. He's not going to be parading the fact that, hey, I'm a man and I just want to come.
Not fluid.
Yeah.
And my favorite quote in that article that you just mentioned there, David, about the Massachusetts, is this guy, he's the co-sponsor of the bill. He said, we are doing the work the founders of our nation intended us to do.
You think so?
I don't think
they ever heard of that.
I don't know if you went back and talked to Washington and all those guys, they'd say that's what they were thinking.
They'd never heard of LGBT. No, it's not in the Constitution.
Hey, some of those guys were in the Whig Party.
Well, there you go.
I think they're wigged out is what we've got here.
There's Darren McGreen there on the mic.
Yeah, thanks, Darren. Yeah, now what it's going to do specifically, it's going to replace the word sex throughout Massachusetts law with the word, with a phrase, gender identity. And it will also mandate, this is important because we can't have private companies, and we can't have churches and other institutions. We can't have people making the decision about how they want to do their bathrooms one way or the other. And then we can't have the the marketplace and the people who go to that business or are a part of that church or club. They can't make that decision as to whether or not they want to go there based on the way the bathrooms are. No, it has to be mandated from the government. And that is the real agenda, boys and girls. Boys and girls, okay? The real agenda.
Not purple penguins.
That's right. The real agenda is this is about government mandates and another aspect of our life. And so here's what they're mandating in Massachusetts. Any public accommodation, and so that means any private business, any church, whatever, shall grant all persons admission to and the full enjoyment of such public accommodation or other entity consistent with the person's gender identity, while finally ordering the Massachusetts Commission Against Discrimination to amend their rules and policies to comply with the redefinition of sex to gender identity. This is the insanity. This is really the Brave New World, because that was a technique of control in Brave New World.
And when you, this is what I want to say to all the people who think things like this are a good idea, not just the bathrooms, but anything where you have the government come in and tell you what to do. If I was, the government, dictator, whatever, and I wanted to do something on Friday that I knew the public would reject, on Monday, I would do something that they wanted me to do.
Yeah.
They would give me that power. So then by Friday, you already gave me that power. I hold this power. I'm going to do this thing that you don't want me to do.
You set up that precedent.
Yeah. So to all the people who set up this precedent, they think it's the greatest deal in the world. The government's coming in and telling you how to run your schools, your bathrooms, or whatever. Watch out, because something else is coming down the pike that you're not going to enjoy.
Well, clearly, that is one thing the founders did understand. We got to remember that the American Revolution was fought over a 3% tax on tea. Could they have paid that tax on tea? Of course they could have paid that tax on tea. It was the principle. It was taxation without representation, which we now have in spades because we have regulation without representation from our bureaucracies. And of course, they're going to tax us. They're going to take away our presumption of innocence and our due process. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Jakari Jackson and our reporters, Coast to Coast. Get BrainForce at 25% off for a limited time at InfowarsLife.com.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've been on this the last few months. You probably noticed I've been more crazed, more focused, less brain fog, more energy, more special reports, and it's because of BrainForce.
One of the worst things with most energy products is it's not sustainable, right? You're going to crash afterwards. And the cool thing about this is it's not just a bunch of energy compounds that are going to fire your brain up to a higher RPM or whatever, which it does do. This is sustainable. This isn't going to spike and you're going to collapse and you're going to feel really bad afterwards. This has a bunch of different antioxidants and compounds and polyphenols.
Everybody's on these drugs to knock their brain out because the brain's so fried.
We're looking at the television screen for research purposes, whatever we're even doing, trying to learn something or staring at the computer all day, working, doing good. You're still damaging your brain.
You will find BrainForce and other game-changing products at InfowarsLife.com or call 888-253-3139.
Get BrainForce at 25% off for a limited time at InfowarsLife.com. And we thank you for your support.
In the past decade, we have witnessed unparalleled scientific discoveries in the area of health. But no one has put together a formula that focuses directly on brain health, nerve growth factors, and optimizing your cellular energy at the same time. DNA Force is one of the most expensive formulas to produce. Some of the ingredients in DNA Force are $12,000 a kilogram. We are using the coveted, patented, only American source of PQQ, CoQ10, and more. You want the best that's out there at the lowest price anywhere? Well, we're bringing you a total win-win. The ultimate value, cutting-edge, trailblazing game changer that also supports the InfoWar. We have produced a limited run of DNA Force, and it will take up to 12 weeks to produce more once we sell out. Secure your DNA Force today at InfowarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139.
Welcome back to the InfoWars Nightly News. This is our live coverage. I'm David Knight with Jakari Jackson. We're going to have our reporters in New Jersey and California joining us with election news as the polls are closing and we start to get updates coming in. We've been talking about the attacks on Donald Trump, calling him a racist because he pushed back against a La Raza judge who is clearly biased against him. There was a piece by Pat Buchanan saying, before we lynch Donald Trump, what was it exactly that he said about this Hispanic judge? Can there be any defense of a statement so horrific as to point out that the guy is of Mexican descent, and the fact that he identifies very strongly with La Raza, with the race, which racially promotes and discriminates against people. And he goes on to point out that, you know, who is this guy? Well, he points out his La Raza connections. He says, but he attacked the independence of the judiciary. Well, we've had presidents like Jefferson and Jackson and FDR who all attacked the independence of the judiciary. And quite frankly, you know, Jakari, I don't know that it's even constitutional to talk about a supreme and independent judiciary. We had a divided government by design mm-hmm. in the Constitution. So I think there should be a tension back and forth between the president and the judiciary. Of course, Jefferson with Marbury versus Madison questioned the idea that the Supreme Court would have the final say on everything by ruling on whether or not it was in compliance with the Constitution and having the last word. He didn't agree with that. I don't agree with that. Later on, when there was a disagreement between President Jackson and the Supreme Court, Jackson said, well, they've made their ruling. Let's see them enforce it.
Right. Okay. And that's what I was talking about in the last segment. You have these separation of powers for the reason, so you can't have the president, like I said, right. just sit, do whatever he wants because he gives you what you want on Monday, and by Friday, he does what he wants to do.
And that's the key issue. That's what I've been trying to explain to libertarians is how can you support Donald Trump because he has so many authoritarian positions that are anti-individual liberty? And it's like, I agree. But when you look at things like eminent domain, which he used for his own personal use, and I've talked about that. I did a report on that. But then you look at what Ted Cruz did. Same thing. Eminent domain, but he did it for the Keystone Pipeline. He wants to take people's property. He wants to allow a Canadian foreign corporation to take their property. How is that different in principle? It's not. And then when you look at what the libertarians are proposing, they're proposing setting up this management of our economy through the Trans-Pacific and Transatlantic Partnerships, calling it free trade. And you've got Gary Johnson saying, well, I'm all for free trade, and I think this is the way to prosperity. And if people in China want to produce goods and services for you at a cheaper price, then let them. They want to be willing slaves to us, then bring on the cheap goods. And it's like, you realize, of course, I would think that after the history of decades of this type of propaganda that we've seen, and I bought into that idea at one point in time, but you realize what has happened, don't you, Gary? We have had our manufacturing base completely disappear. And we were told at the time, this is going to be great. They're going to make all this stuff, Jakari. We aren't going to have to worry with the pollution. We don't get to do dirty, backbreaking jobs. They're going to make do all the heavy manufacturing for us. And we don't even have to worry about that. We'll just have this nice little service job. Well, now that we've got the service jobs, we're going to find that the next thing is we move to the gig economy, where we all work for Uber, that sort of thing. And Gary Johnson talked about that in the debates. He said, hey, Uber is great. That is the path of the future. You know, Uber cars, Uber everything, okay, until they take that away. And I think the best example of this, and a lot of people didn't understand the gist of the report last night when I talked about Jeff Bezos and these billionaires' space race. As I pointed out last night, it truly is a Sputnik moment. These guys have been working on the development of the space program for, and Bezos' case, since 2000. So he's been working on this for 16 years. And it was only last November that he got his first successful launch. And he edged out Elon Musk in that. He was able to launch a rocket up to the Kármán line, which is the line between the atmosphere and space. Above that line, you can't have a plane fly. There's not enough oxygen atmosphere up there. So that's mm-hmm. truly outer space. So he's able to launch his rocket up there, bring it back, land it on Earth at a particular spot, reuse that completely. Okay, these guys are building an infrastructure. Why are they doing it? Well, Elon Musk is looking at it as the ultimate prepper issue. But as I pointed out, the thing that concerns me about Bezos is that this is a move, I believe, to go to the next step. I think it's the end game of both the globalist crony capitalism and this kind of world government, because he's going to build an infrastructure and an elitist community. If you saw the movie Elysium, remember?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
They showed those toroids, those outer space communities, and that is what they've been working on designing it. And when I did this report last night, Jakari, I looked at some of the comments. Most of these comments are like, these guys are absolute shills. We know they didn't go to the moon. That was a total lie. The Earth is flat and all this other kind of stuff. And look, I understand. We've had Alex talk to a guy who was on the front line of mission control at Houston. He says, well, I got my doubts as to whether or not we actually went to the moon. I understand. I don't trust the government. But I do know that the Earth is not flat, okay?
I agree with that.
We can talk about the science of this. We can talk about they could do a fraud. They are going to be able to do this type of thing. And we've had Hugo de Garis talk about the Arctic War. He says, hey, look, when people realize where this is all headed, and this goes to Elon Musk's scenario, he says, all these disruptive technologies are going to get out of control. Well, Hugo de Garis talked about that. He said, there's going to be a war between the people and the scientists who want to move ahead with these disruptive technologies and the people who realize how this is going to threaten their way of life. Once that happens, the elites will pull back to their space colonies and they'll continue with their development. And that's precisely what Jeff Bezos is talking
about. Well, we've already seen these guys do this here on Earth, not so much with the rockets, but when you talk about these guys who hollow out entire mountains to put their fallout shelters in there.
Yes.
You know, they've done entire documentaries about this. So they say that you're a crazy prepper if you got a, you know, a cabinet full of pork and beans. But these guys got fallout shelters, armed bodyguards, the whole nine to survive whatever they foresee is coming.
And so Elon Musk wants to prep by going to Mars and setting up a colony there. Bezos, and this is what I pointed out last night, was looking at what the physicist and the rocket scientists were putting together in the 1970s, specifically the physicist Gerard K. O'Neill. He came up with a design for space colonies that could be built in manufacturing areas that would be in these special areas called Lagrange libration points. This, Jakari, is some of the most valuable real estate in the galaxy, because this is where you can put these things close to the moon. They can shoot material up to it and manufacture in those areas. So when he's talking about manufacturing, and this is one of the key things that he said out of the conference that he had, people talked about his conflict back and forth with Donald Trump. But what he said was, I want to turn the Earth, I want to zone it for residential and light manufacturing only. In other words, he's going to have a monopoly on all of manufacturing. So it isn't just going to be, yeah, let's play that clip from that conference. Let's play that. It's a 14-second clip.
All of our heavy industry will be moved off planet, and Earth will be zoned residential and light industrial. And that just makes a lot of sense. You shouldn't be.
But he's dead serious. On Earth. You hear the audience laughing. He says, we're going to zone the Earth. We're going to zone the Earth residential and light industrial. And people, ha, 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 he didn't crack a smile. He wasn't joking. That's what they're going to do. That's Agenda 21. Agenda 21, as a matter of fact, the residential that's going to happen, we've seen what it looks like with Agenda 21. They're going to concentrate everybody in the cities. Most of the Earth is going to be zoned off limits to you. And then, of course, they're going to say, well, you know, anybody will be able to go to these Lagrange libration points. They'll be able to manufacture there. If you've got a rocket system, if you're a multi-billionaire.
Yeah, okay, it'd be a fair rocket, market if you got your rocket system going.
So, yeah, you're going to have to have them do all the manufacturing for you. And this is what we have seen from Bezos. He's very, very intelligent, very, very calculating. He plays the long game. Okay, you think about it from Sputnik to 1969 when Nixon announced that we'd landed on the moon. Okay, 12 years. For 16 years, well, 15 years, it was November. For 15 years, he was developing a rocket system. Okay, he's taking a long-term view. This is not a flash in the pan. And he's looking to get this done in his lifetime. A couple of million people living in space colonies. You're talking about the elite of the elite. Mm-hmm. 2 million people, 1 to 2 million people out of the population of billions that we have here on Earth. And then they're going to have a monopoly on manufacturing. And there you can see those special points there. 1 and 2 are close to the moon. And there you can just send material up with the magnetic rail gun that was also developed by O'Neill. And we now see that with the Navy guns. I mean, that's accomplished fact. They could create those space colonies there for manufacturing. And then the zones marked L5 and L4, you can put something there and leave that indefinitely. You don't even have to manage that.
Guys, real quick, just found out when we come back from break, we will have InfoWars News Director Rob Due live from...
You talk about leveling with the American people. Have you always told the truth?
I've always tried to. You know, is she in it for us or is she in it for herself?
What difference at this point does it make?
Donald Trump has already sealed the deal for the Republican nomination. But will Bernie's wrecking crew be out in full force to tear the roof off when Clinton's camp steals California?
You know...
Excuse me, I'm talking.
Let him sprung.
Join me and the rest of the InfoWars crew this Tuesday, June 7th at 7 p.m. We're going to be going live to document Hillary's last stand.
I don't feel no ways tired. I come too far.
So you ask my opinion, I will tell you my opinion. I'm not going to be channeling my husband.
Join us live this Super Tuesday at 7 p.m. Central for the InfoWars Nightly News.
Today, we are going to look at this judge who has been ruling basically against Trump and doing unprecedented things in the Trump University case. And I'll be honest with you, I've kind of ignored Trump University to a certain extent. I've done some research. But after Trump came out and said, this guy is a Mexican, and by Mexican, his loyalty is to Mexico. And so I did some research and found out, wow, Trump needs to go further here. This guy is the head lawyer over a lawyer group based in California that for decades has been promoting basically race-based brainwashing. Now, I don't like the Ku Klux Klan, but Mecha and La Raza and organizations like this, as John Bowne's report is up on InfoWars.com, The Hidden Hand of Hate breaks down, these guys basically operate just like the Klan. They say, for those inside our race, everything. For those outside the race, nothing. La Raza means the race. So I see Trump say this about this judge, and I think, what, you're just saying because he's Mexican and his heritage and he ruled against you? Has Trump gone too far? And I go look it up, and the guy is worse than what Trump's saying. And that's the problem. Trump will just throw something out that's true, but then, I guess with the sound bites, not get into the whole background of it. So we're going to talk about this judge a little bit right now. But I tell you, it's a fair headline to say that this judge is the equivalent of a Hispanic Grand Dragon. And John Bowne's report breaks down the Democrats, the history of the Klan. It's easy to organize people around race-based systems. You know, the Klan says they're persecuted, too. Well, Mecha and La Raza say that as well. So I got to say, Donald Trump is completely right again. This ties into the whole Trump University. I know that the Clintons have their own much bigger scandal. Roger Stone is here to break this down. But this judge, Gonzalo Curiel, this guy is simply amazing. And now we know why he is doing things in these rulings that's unprecedented. I just hope Trump unloads on him with, like, this Daily Caller article. Judge presiding over Trump University case is a member of La Raza. And again, that means the race. People say, well, that's okay because Hispanics can say we're a racial group, but whites, if you say we're in a racial group, it's bad. No, when people organize politically and say we're only for our group, classically liberal views are that's dangerous and bad, a la Adolf Hitler. Roger Stone, what do you have to say?
Well, Alex, I think, first of all, that it's important to establish that the judge is not only a Mexican radical, he's also a Hillary Clinton contributor. But let's put this entire entire Trump University question into context. Trump University was a real estate course, and it was a very successful one for many people. Now, there were a very small percentage of students who were unhappy with the success of the course because they didn't go out and make $1 million immediately. There's an overwhelming satisfaction rate. The number of dollars involved here are relatively small. This scandal pales in comparison to Laureate University. Laureate University is a multi-million dollar scam, essentially a series of colleges and schools where people were induced to load up on enormous personal debt. And then the college hired, or Laureate hired Bill Clinton as their chancellor, paid him $16 million, which was illegally concealed for 5 years, never reported as required by law. And the IFC, the International Finance Corporation, would give the schools $150 million. On top of that, Hillary Clinton's State Department would give Laureate $55 million. It turns out the guy running Laureate, Becker, is a convicted felon, a scamster, who has also benefited and been a major donor to the Clinton Foundation. So Trump needs to counterpunch, Alex. He needs to be very blunt. Trump University, nothing compared to the scandal at Laureate University. The real question is, why isn't Laureate University on the front page of every paper in America instead of Trump University.
I want to get back into the university. I want to get back into Mecha and La Raza. When I sit here and say that La Raza and Mecha are communistic, anti-white, racist organizations, I'm not exaggerating. Look it up. And I protested them. I protested the Klan. I find it distasteful.
You think we have kids because we like sex? No, we're having kids ready to start this war. Believe me. I got another one on the way, and she'll be strapped up, ready for you. Come get it. Come get it. Come knock on my door and see what happens. We're ready. We're ready. Ashe, talk me, Ashe.
But the difference from the Klan is people know it's bad. It's being eradicated. Politically, people are turning away from it for decades. With the Metro and La Raza, it's pushed by the Fortune 500. It's pushed by the media. Because they want it.
Yeah, it's politically correct. It's almost chic. It's radical chic to be for these poor Mexican people.
And it's like Hispanics or whites or whoever wearing Che Guevara shirts when he said Native Americans, Mesoamericans, were dumb animals. I don't think they are. I think they're great people. And, you know, there's this elitism with these communist groups and others that make me sick. But getting back to this, let's talk inside stuff with Trump and give me your real take on this. I know you will, or you'll just say you won't answer. Is this a pattern with Trump on purpose? Because he always puts out a little info. It sounds incendiary, and every time it turns out to be true, where he says this guy is a radical, he's a Mexican, he isn't for America because he's a Mexican. And I think, man, that's not true. A lot of people I know are some of the best Americans there are, super patriots. And then I go research. This guy is a flaming Grand Dragon, radical Hispanic racist. And so they're attacking him. Is Trump waiting, knowing the rest will come out and he's proven right again? Am I wrong in saying Trump should do the data dump up front? Or did he just read an article, see the intel, say it, but not go all the way? I mean, is this planned or is this Trump only launching half of his bullets?
I think it's instinctual, Alex. I think that he understands that in the pressures of a campaign, you only can get so much data out. On the other hand, as the presumptive nominee, he can always get covered. And therefore, I think it's seriatim, meaning first you put out the red meat, he attacks the judge. Now he's going to develop that. And then he'll move to the counterpunch on Laureate. This issue is going to redound to his benefit because he's not a sitting duck.
So that is what he's doing, though. He's smart, man. This is the guy we need as a president. I mean, it's very Machiavellian, but in a good way.
Well, he understands the need to get your story out there in clips, in bites that people can digest. The people aren't interested in a long treatise on Laureate or Trump University. They want to get to the essence of this issue.
So he puts it out. He knows the establishment thinks they can misrepresent it. He waits. He baits them. And then all the data comes out.
Not only that, but if he wants to be on CNN or Fox tomorrow, he simply has to make a phone call and he can get a 20-minute or 30-minute bite in which he can develop this in a way that is more effective than as a segment of a speech in front of 30,000 people. So, look, he's smart like a fox. He understands the news cycle. He understands the need to stay on offense. Who else would have the nerve to say Hillary Clinton is a criminal? She has misrepresented the status of 30,000 emails. And she needs to go to prison. And if I become president, folks, remember, there's a 5-year statute of limitation on these crimes. In essence, saying he will prosecute her and he will send her to jail. I'm sorry, I don't see Chris Christie or Marco Rubio.
Yeah, no. He's delivering on everything he said he would do so far. He's not just taking the gloves off. He's put brass knuckles on because he said Hillary is punching him. He's going to punch back, as you said, twice as hard. Stone's rules over there. We're going to go to break here in a moment, but coming up in part two during the Sunday broadcast, 4 to 6 p.m. Central, we are going to get into the really big issue, and I'm concerned about this too. Are libs infiltrating the campaign? We know about Trump's daughter, you know, hanging out with Chelsea. We know about the son-in-law with the Democrat connections, though I see him doing a lot of good work out there and saying a lot of great things. You've told me you're going to really give us absolutely the truth. And I got to say, Roger, I'm impressed knowing you a year. I've known you years, but really known you good for a year. Everything you've ever said has turned out to be dead on accurate. It's really amazing. So you're going to tell us the inside scoop.
I am indeed.
All right. StoneZone.com, InfoWars.com, of course, is our site. We've only got about 30 seconds till we go to break. Just getting back to this whole college deal. You go sign up for real estate school. It's the average price I've seen for good schools out there. It's what you take away from it. Of course, there's going to be a few sour grapes. 98% approval rating in this compared to the Clintons. getting $150 million and doing nothing with it and stealing it. And this is their MO. It's incredible, Roger.
Not to mention the enormous debt that they've saddled individual working class people with. This is was a boiler room. It was a scam. In other words, you would have these telephone boiler rooms.
All right, we're going to cut live, kind of get into this report with Roger Stone and Alex Jones, because we've got Donald Trump live now in New Jersey. And, of course, they have announced him, and they called him as the winner in New Jersey. 83% of the vote for Donald Trump in New Jersey, they've called it for him. They've also called it for Hillary Clinton, 59% of the vote in New Jersey. But let's listen to what Donald Trump is saying right now.
My goal is always again to bring people together. But if I'm forced to fight for something I really care about, I will never, ever back down. And our country will never, ever back down.
See, I think that's important. All these other politicians are saying, just back off of this. Don't push on this issue. This isn't about his personal pride. Family. This is about having a justice system that works.
I fought for my employees, and now I'm going to fight for you, the American people.
If he won't fight for himself, he's not going to fight for you. And that's what we've seen repeatedly from the people who have lied to us to get elected, like Paul Ryan.
Fighting.
That's
a
good point, Dave.
You're going to see some real good things happen. Just remember this. I'm going to be your champion. I'm going to be America's champion. Because you see, this election isn't about Republican or Democrat. It's about who runs this country, the special interests or the people, and I mean the American people.
Yeah. Right, it's about globalism versus nationalism.
Every election year, politicians promise change. Obama promised change, and it didn't work out too well. And every year, they fail to deliver. Why would politicians want to change a system that's totally rigged in order to keep them in power? That's what they're doing, folks. Why would politicians want to change a system that's made them and their friends very, very wealthy? Yeah. I beat a rigged system by winning with overwhelming support, the only way you could have done it. Landslides all over the country, with every demographic on track to win 37 primary caucus victories in a field that began with 17 very talented people. After years of disappointment, there's one thing we all have learned. We can't fix the rigged system by relying on very, and I mean this so, so strongly, on the very people who rigged it. And they rigged it. And do not ever think anything differently. We can't solve our problems by counting on the politicians who created our problems. The Clintons have turned the politics of personal enrichment into an art form for themselves.
That's absolutely true. They're no better example of it. And if you're going to let these guys get away with rigging the court system, with rigging everything else, then he's going to cave, and he's going to compromise and let them rig everything else. He's not going to get anything done. This is very good news. Great speech.
Selling favors, selling government contracts, and I mean hundreds of millions of dollars. Secretary Clinton even did all of the work on a totally illegal private server. Something that how she's getting away with this, folks, nobody understands. Designed to keep her corrupt dealings out of the public record, putting the security of the entire country at risk,
yes.
And a president in a corrupt system is totally protecting her. Not right.
He's absolutely right about that.
I am going to give a major speech on probably Monday of next week, and we're going to be discussing all of the things that have taken place with the Clintons. I think you're going to find it very informative and very, very interesting.
Welcome to the general election, Hillary. Hey, what he said about that server, she put national security secrets at risk to protect her private criminal records. That's the point, folks.
Hillary Clinton turned the State Department into her private hedge fund. The Russians, yeah. The Saudis, the Chinese all gave money to Bill and Hillary and got favorable treatment in return. Yes. It's a sad day in America when foreign governments with deep pockets have more influence in our own country than our great citizens. I didn't need to do this. It's not easy. Believe me, I didn't need to do it. But I felt I had to give back to our wonderful country, which has been so good to me and to my family.
You know, this is something we've been talking about for 25 years. The Clintons got away with all this. We knew that there were quid pro quo favors being bought by Chinese representatives. All they had to do was confess to it. They gave them probation instead of prison. The Clintons didn't get prison. They didn't even get probation. They got away with it. And that's what he's going to expose next week. This is going to be great.
They literally, these jobs have virtually disappeared. An embarrassment to our country, and it's horrible. I've embraced the victims of illegal immigration, moms and dads who have had to bury their own children because of people that shouldn't have been in the country. Remember it, folks. Remember it.
That's right. And it's not just violence and criminals. You're going to be burying your family members because they don't even screen people for diseases that they're bringing into this country.
Struggling schools. I've seen our dilapidated airports, highways, bridges, and I've compared them to other countries where we see facilities so far superior to ours, it's really not to be believed. Hard to imagine what's happened to our country. America is getting taken apart piece by piece, auctioned off to the highest bidder. We're broke. Mm-hmm. We're broke. We owe $19 trillion, going quickly to $21 trillion. Our infrastructure is a disaster.
We're just waiting for the Chinese and the Saudis to call the loan.
Crime is rising. People are scared. The last thing we need is Hillary Clinton in the White House or an extension of the Obama disaster.
Right. I think this is the best speech I've ever seen Donald Trump give. He's right on point. He's saying things that need to be said, things that Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell and Newt Gingrich would never say. Why? Because they want to feed at that trough. That's why they let them get away with it, isn't it, Jakari? They won't impeach Obama because they think they're going to get
the same power.
That's right.
We love our country.
That's right.
But we can turn this all around. We're going to do it by putting America first. That commitment is the foundation for change that's been missing, and it's been missing for a long time. It's important to understand what America First means. It means on foreign policy, we will never enter into any conflict unless it makes us safer as a nation. It has to make us safer as a nation. This is the opposite of Hillary's foreign policy, which invaded Libya, destabilized Iraq, unleashed ISIS, and threw Syria into chaos and created the mass migration, which is wreaking havoc all over the world, and while putting Iran on the path to nuclear weapons and making them a dominant power in the Middle East.
We gotta hope that Trump will be wise enough to realize that any foreign intervention, any entanglement alliances do not make us safer. Our founders understood that, and hopefully that's what he means when he says he's not gonna get involved in something unless it makes us safer. I hope that he will do that.
We're not supposed to play Team America World Police.
That's right.
A lot of people think that's what we're supposed to do. But if you think about the situation, like what happened in Libya, you know, you have a guy in Gaddafi who's not a good guy, but he is a threat mainly regionally.
Yeah.
Are the American people safer now that Gaddafi's gone and the terrorist organizations who want to come here and kill us have taken over?
Absolutely not. And not if we get Assad out of Syria. Things would get worse there as well. We're going to leave this for the moment because we have our reporter coming to us live from Europe. Rob Du is in Dresden, Germany, I believe. Rob, are you there?
Yes, I am here. David Knight, how's it going?
Doing good. We're just listening to, I think, probably the best speech I've heard Donald Trump give. He said he's not going to back down on this issue with the judge because he said, I'm not going to compromise on my personal integrity, and you can trust me to not compromise on issues of national importance for the same reason. If he's going to compromise on something like this just to win election, we know he's going to compromise on everything in order to win election. Did we lose Rob on Skype?
I think I'm still here.
We got him back. Okay, go ahead. Go ahead, Rob.
I'm getting all kinds of, I'm getting late texts, this and that, and things are coming forward, but I think we are on the air.
Yes.
David, I just got a letter as I came back to my room tonight. It's now 3 a.m. in Dresden, Germany, where I'm coming to you live. This is from the Hotel Taschenberger Palais Kempinski, which is where the Bilderberg is going to be held. This is the letter they sent under my door, and here's the letter right here. I'm going to read it to you. We would hereby like to inform you that our hotel is booked exclusively on Wednesday, June 8th, 2016 of June. We therefore kindly ask you to leave your room and remove your car from the garage before 12. Kindly note that after 12 noon, an exit is not possible anymore.
Oh, you'll be trapped so there.
I might be trapped.
We'll never see you again.
We thank you for in advance for your understanding. Should you have any further questions, please do not hesitate to contact us directly. Guess who's going to be contacting them directly in the morning?
Are they throwing you out early? Were you already booked through tomorrow?
We were booked through tomorrow. And it's just, this is just a very threatening note. And the people I read this to earlier, I was with a couple other German nationals who were here that said, this is very threatening. This is threatening language. Like, what does that mean? Afternoon, an exit is not possible anymore.
So, yeah, it is.
There is no escape.
There is no escape. I may be stuck here with Henry Kissinger smelling his whatever. His,
well, you know the old joke about hell and how it's these different ethnic groups, and one of the aspects of hell was the police are all German.
Yeah, and you know, today I was going around shooting video. I posted that about the German military that was here meeting with the hotel staff, working on security. And that hadn't been anywhere in the news. I hadn't seen that anywhere. So I talked with another journalist who had actually talked to those people having the meeting. And that person thought they were police. So they were going to find out, oh, what are the rules for the press? Where can we go? What can we do? And they were told that we're not police, we're military, and we can't answer those questions. So it was very interesting. And then I showed them the video. I said, is this who you're talking about? She said, oh yeah, those are the people, they're military. And mm-hmm. You can see on the epaulets on their uniform. So it's kind of a dark interior iPhone video, but you can clearly make out the uniforms that four of the people are wearing, four of the men. And then there's two women that they're talking with, presumably from the hotel staff.
Well, you know, that's the problem.
Yep.
That's the problem, Rob, isn't it? Everywhere we go, it's becoming increasingly difficult to distinguish the police from the military, and it's becoming increasingly difficult to distinguish the people who work for a particular country versus those who work for the multinational globalists, as you see there in Bilderberg. I mean, that's who these people are really working for.
Exactly, and one of which is coming as your favorite, Lindsey Graham. You don't have a lawyer.
He's gonna be there.
He's gonna be coming. So I'm thinking he's either here to try to subvert the Trump campaign, or maybe to pick out some of the lineup of escorts, the male escorts that might be coming here. He might be in charge of that. That might be his.
He might just be checking out the transgender bathrooms in Germany, see if they got some.
That's true. You know, and I haven't seen those yet. They say Damen and they say Herren. I haven't seen any. We don't know him. You know.
So, don't ask, don't tell.
It's been quite interesting here. Met a lot of nice people so far. There's some guys that have just produced a documentary. Apparently in Ramstein, there is a drone base that was kind of a secret drone base. And these guys have kind of blown the lid on it with a documentary. So I'm hoping to get a copy of that and put that out to people and let them know about it. So there's a secret drone base going on in Ramstein, Germany, where they're, you know, flying their missions and, you know, killing wedding parties, innocent villagers, children.
That's right.
You know, every once in a while they get a terrorist, maybe. We don't know.
The Ramstein is an American Air Force base there in Germany.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So, but they are running drone missions out of there, which before, mm-hmm. I guess they weren't doing that. So that was, I was talking to their cameraman. I did a short interview with him. And then I met some, last year, remember we, had some confrontations with some of the Bilderberg attendees. Franco Burnaby was one, and also Oscar Bronner, but the guy that was instrumental in making those confrontations happen showed up today. And so I met with him. He was on the show earlier. His name's Mr. Tillman. Mm-hmm. And then I did a podcast with them as well. In addition to, you know, uploading the other videos we've been working on and shooting and all that. So, you know, it's been quite an adventure.
I'm looking at the list of attendees that Paul Joseph Watson posted. It's mm-hmm. up on Infowars.com. Drudge linked to it. Bilderberg 2016 to talk Trump, riots, migrants, and Brexit. I'm looking through this list here, and, you know, one of the names I don't see on here, Rob, is Ed Balls from the U.K. He was, when we were in Copenhagen, he got stuck. Karen got pictures of him, my wife, as he was trying to get in without his pass. And they said, no, you're not going to get in. They go, don't you know who I am?
He had all the papers.
That's right. Yeah, so he starts going through his roll-on suitcase. And as he opened it up, all these papers, it was filled with papers, not any clothing at all. It was all filled with folders of papers that go spilling out, and it's like, oh, so this is a meeting where, you know, there's just an informal meeting, and he's just coming in here with some, you know, it's just going to be a light stay for the weekend. No, it was all about paperwork.
Business, yeah.
And, you know, he was the highest official that got a lot of coverage in the UK. People in the US didn't know who he was. He was the shadow minister for the Exchequer for the Treasury Department, if you want to translate into English, and he was the opposition person that was put in that place. He was the highest official who lost in the last British elections, was Ed Ball. So there are some consequences for some of these things.
There are. So I guess you don't get the support when you spill the beans, essentially. You don't get the support of the powers that be. So, it's an interesting list. Vernon Jordan, of course, is on it. James Johnson, those guys attended last year. Eric Schmidt, Peter Thiel. Also, the head of LinkedIn is going to be here. So there's always that technological angle where they can figure out how they're going to track and trace you. Yeah, David Petraeus.
He's one of the key regulars now. Alex Karp, I see him there. I remember seeing him in Copenhagen doing his
Bloomberg. This year also interesting is the chief foreign correspondent of NBC who looks eerily like the Ambassador Stevens who died in Benghazi, if you take a look at his picture. Mm-hmm. The NBC foreign correspondent. He's the chief foreign correspondent, but I'm sure he won't be talking about his adventures in Bilderberg.
Yeah.
Also, the editor of Bloomberg, the editor of The Economist, they were here last year. So a lot of media figures, and of course, we're not going to see or hear a thing or a peep from these people about the media. I think people should start blowing up their Twitter accounts, especially these media people.
Yeah.
Hey, what are you doing in Bilderberg? What are you going to talk about? Are you going to write about it?
Peggy
Just
Noonan.
So we know what's going on.
Peggy mm-hmm. Noonan, the speechwriter for Ronald Reagan, frequent contributor to the Wall Street Journal. That's a familiar name there. You see her a lot. Of course, you know, she's not so comfortable with Donald Trump. You know, just doesn't do it for her, you know? Just doesn't do it for all those Wall Street, National Review, Weekly Standard people. You know, he just, no, he's not on with that globalist agenda, is he?
Yeah, and definitely neither. Lindsey Graham is definitely not a fan of Donald Trump. So I'm hoping to get a question into Lindsey, you know, asking if he minds violating the Logan Act.
Mm-hmm.
You know, is he here to subvert the Trump campaign? And then also, you know, what's his favorite flavor of boy? And will he be picking out the boys for Kissinger? You know, I think the public has a right to know that stuff. And Lindsey Graham may not want to answer it, but, you know, we're going to. Hopefully I'll get some questions in there. You know, like in Copenhagen, there's not a big security perimeter. We showed some video of that earlier. Yeah, it's a very small perimeter out in the front. Incidentally enough, though, they managed to block off part of a road, but they keep there's a triangle, a pyramid, if you will, with a circle in the middle of it. Mm-hmm. And then there's three openings in the circle, and one of the openings goes right into the front door of the Kabnitsky Hotel, which is also called the Grand Hotel Taschenberg Palais. So that is the hotel where we were at.
Isn't that special?
They say it's a 5-star hotel. I have cobwebs up on my light over here.
Well, just be glad it's not a 1-star hotel.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so, I see also that Robert Rubin is going to be there, the Council on Foreign Relations co-chair.
Yep.
Yeah. So, yeah, there's some heavy hitters here. We could go down and we could break out a lot of these people. But as you point out, there's a lot of people from the media, The Economist, Bloomberg, mm-hmm. Wall Street Journal, several of them here from Bloomberg, of course. We would expect that, wouldn't we?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, of course, because, you know, Bilderberg doesn't exist. And, you know, I just think it's funny that these guys come to this meeting, they're media figures, and yet, no, well, it's Robert's Rules of Engagement or Robert's Rules of Order, so we don't talk about it. Or Chatham House Rules is what they say.
Chatham House Rules.
So we can't talk about anything. You know, where do your loyalties lie? Do they lie to Chatham House or do they lie to your country?
It's kind of like the police who say, you know, when they're using Stingray illegally to do dragnet surveillance and they, use parallel construction, they bring somebody in and the judge says, wait a minute, where's your warrant? And they go, well, how'd you obtain this information? I can't really tell you that. I've got a non-disclosure agreement that I signed with a corporation.
You don't have
a non-disclosure agreement with this court.
Yeah.
And where's your warrant? And they say, oh, never mind. We'll just let this guy go. But that's it.
They want to know everything about you and where you're going and what you're doing. But, you know, you want to ask them a question about what they're doing in this private meeting, and you're not going to get anything. You're going to get nada from these people. So it'll be interesting to see what happens. They'll probably start trickling in tomorrow. We're going to have a pretty big team. I talked with Tillman. He's got three guys with him, and we've got an extra camera. So I'm going to put one in one of their hands, and they got a couple cameras. So we're going to have many angles covered here at InfoWars. And that's all thanks to the people out there supporting us at InfoWars Life and becoming Prison Planet TV members. So definitely I want to really thank all the members out there. And also thank you for your tips. We got the interview with Muhammad the Migrant because of an email tip from somebody who lived in a very small town of 38,000 people, said, hey, I know where there's a place, and gave me the exact address. I looked it up. I'm like, oh, it's a building. Okay, let's go check it out. And sure enough, there's six men sitting in the back on a picnic table doing nothing because they're not allowed to do anything. They bring them here, they give them shelter, food, and then they say, you can't get a job. You know, so you're
that's just
guaranteed
to make them a problem. It's just going to make them angry and resentful.
Idle hands are the devil's playground, right?
That's right.
I mean, we've heard that since we were little. And so these guys are sitting around. They're getting glaring looks from the Germans in the area because they're going, hey, you're freeloaders. What are you doing?
Yeah.
And these guys are going, we can't do anything. You know, they won't let us. So it's just like what they did with the ghettos and the public housing back in the 60s, bringing people in. Oh, you have a husband? Well, you're not qualified. If you don't have a husband and have kids, you're qualified. So we're going to bring down your standard of living and break up your family. It's the same deal here. Bringing in a bunch of people, creating a freeloader class, but giving them enough money to go out into the community and buy things, but not really doing anything, not participating in the community, not integrating into the community. And what are you going to get? Ticking time bombs.
Lock them down and keep them from doing anything. It's what we did to the Indians on the reservation, isn't it?
There you go.
Just shut them down on the socialist reservation and say, you can't do a thing. We'll feed you a little bit. And they're doing that now to the people where they have confiscated their logging rights, their mineral rights up in Oregon and that sort of thing. They said, no, don't worry about it. We're not going to let you be loggers anymore, but we'll give you some welfare benefits from the government. They only did it for 10 years. Now that money has stopped and there's nothing else that people there are allowed to do. And so that economy is crashing big time. And that really, the government is deliberately setting up the foundations of conflict. And they're bringing these people in, putting them in a difficult situation, as you're just describing there in Germany, making the Germans angry at them at the same time.
Yeah.
And pitting these two groups against each other when the real problem is the government. I saw that throughout the South. You know, it's the results of Reconstruction that happened after the Civil War. They got both sides fighting each other, and it was really what the Federals wanted. They wanted to stir it up.
Exactly. Yeah, they were bringing carpetbaggers in from the north, making them the overlords.
Mm-hmm.
And we saw that in Munich when we went to one of the migrant camps, which is, you know, basically a converted building. And we started talking to a couple of the guys from Afghanistan and outrun these North Africans. You know, so they probably came in the year before. Now they're the overseers. They're the enforcers. So they create this, you know, a little entitlement class inside this other, you know, oppressed class. And so they're just creating these things and, oh, we don't want you talking to them. We don't want you might be a danger to them. What do you mean I might be a danger to them? I have a microphone in my hand and a camera. I'm not any danger to anybody. I'm just asking questions. And, you know, maybe you should be answering some questions. So these people don't want to answer questions. You start asking them questions, they retreat. Then their German handlers come out, go, hey, I have to make some phone calls. We might have to confiscate your footage. And I said, oh, okay, we're going to just go wait in our car. You know, I'm not waiting around for any kind of confiscation of footage happening. Right. I still, even though I'm not in the United States, I still follow, the Constitution and Bill of Rights. And I'm, you know, if they have a problem with that, they can have a problem with that. I'll let the chips fall where they may.
We got Joe Biggs, who has been waiting to talk to us out in California. But Rob, is there anything before we go to Joe, anything else that you want to tell us that's coming up special tomorrow besides your pending eviction and early eviction?
Exactly. That'll be interesting. I'm going to go confront them tomorrow and find out what they mean by kindly note that after 12 noon, an exit is not possible anymore. Do they lock everything up and kick us out, and then they'll just confiscate the car that we have in the garage? I mean, what are these people going to do? Because our lords and saviors, the elites, are going to be coming in and ruling over us. And these people don't understand. They're plotting their future. So that's the staff that's going along with this, they don't understand they're being played just like everyone else. But they're willing participants in being played by themselves. So they need to wake up. I've talked to a few of them. I've talked to a couple wait staff. I've talked to a couple of the bellhops trying to create, you know, just plant the seeds. Hey, when they're mean to you guys and when they treat you like dog poop, you know, you're going to want to talk about it. So, hey, I'm going to be right down the road. Come talk to me and we can get this stuff out because, hey, it's your world too. And you can be a sheep. You know, we were up at the ruins of this Castle Wolfstein, and there's some sheep right around who were just, you know, and it was funny. We went to go take pictures of the sheep, and one of them ran off, and the other ones who were eating just immediately ran off and followed the sheep. I mean, sheep or sheep? Do you want to be a sheep, or do you want to be free? You know, so that's
herd
what
mentality.
We're gonna be trying to prove. It is. Yeah. And definitely, you know, I saw some amazing things here with, you know, their Perugita march the other day on Monday. You know, several thousand people showed up for that, and that was interesting. But it was also, it was very subdued. It was very quiet. It was very somber. It was very polite. You know, Germans seem to be like that. They're very orderly. They're very polite. But, you know, they're pissed. But I don't know if what they're doing now is really being efficient. They need to go after these politicians, the ones that are creating these types of policies that are bringing in migrants, and then stop that at the source instead of just, you know, we're going to march around with flags every Monday because they've been doing it and it's not stopping. The only reason it's stopping now is because every country around Germany has closed its borders because they see the problem. Mm-hmm. Germany is going, hey, come on in. We'll still find a place for you. You know,
well, not so much Germany as it is Angela Merkel. And so we're going to see what happens. Brexit is their big hope, I think. Well, we'll find out tomorrow, Rob, if exit will be possible for you or if you're going to find out finally what Arbeit macht frei means, okay?
exactly. Hey, thanks for joining. This is Rob Dew live from Dresden, Germany for InfoWars.com.
Thank you, Rob. Great talking to you. Let's go to our reporter, Joe Biggs, who is live in California, from Germany to California. Joe.
Hey there, David. This is Joe Biggs with InfoWars.com. Now I'm standing outside of the Bernie Sanders rally that will be taking place in less than an hour and a half. We're actually in Santa Monica. And if you look over here, you can see a line that's already starting to form around here. It's not that many people out here yet, but there's still about an hour and a half to go. It's a smaller venue, much like we saw with Hillary Clinton's rally yesterday. What we're going to do here in a little bit is go around and talk to people, ask them if they feel like they're being cheated, what they think about Hillary Clinton. And I want to hear some of these people, Bernie Sanders impersonations. It should be pretty interesting.
Sure. You're going to go talk to them now while we're live here and ask them how they feel about this? Because, you know, the AP came out and told everybody that she had exactly the number of delegates that she needed. Not one less, not one more, but exactly the number needed. So here was the message to all those voters in California. Just stay home. It's over, folks. That's what they're telling them, right?
Yeah. I mean, it's pretty interesting that they're going to come out and just call it for them. I mean, you know how the Hillary Clinton campaign has been, how the Clintons are in general. Yeah. They're always trying to use these Jedi mind tricks on people to make them think that they've got something or they've won something. But it's simply not there yet. I mean, there's a lot of people in California and across the country who show up to his rallies in far larger numbers than hers at all. I mean, it's just completely ridiculous. And like with the video we talked about yesterday, where I showed you the larger stadium beside the smaller one, these are the kind of tricks they play. So I don't see it. I don't think it's going to go down without a fight. Today's going to be very interesting to see how it turns out.
Well, the thing I'm noticing, Joe, as I'm looking at this crowd, you know, I've been to many of these rallies as you have. When you go to a Trump rally, there are Bernie Sanders supporters attacking the Trump people. When I look at this Bernie Sanders rally, I don't see anybody attacking these Bernie Sanders supporters.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, just like with yesterday as well, you know, there were maybe 10 to 12 of us standing outside. There were Trump supporters outside of this Hillary Clinton event. And I even walked up to the police officer and said, hey, you guys, you're welcome for us not rioting. You know, sorry, we don't do that. All the hooligans are inside the Clinton rally right now. You know, so most people, they're going to be out doing something bad or in one of these rallies. You know, it's just interesting when you see that, how we can go out here and we can come to one of these rallies. We can have an intelligent conversation with these people, even though we don't agree on all the subjects. We can still sit down, come together, and understand that we do have one thing in common, that we don't want Hillary Clinton in the White House. So that is pretty interesting within itself.
You know, as we look at what's going on, the Bernie supporters not happy with the process, not happy with the superdelegates. I think one of the things that was very key was the fact that as we looked at the number of delegates that were allocated based on voting, this is ignoring the superdelegates for a moment, she had 1,812 and he had 1,521. So there's about 290 separating them. There's really pretty close. And so I think the hope of Bernie Sanders and his supporters was that with a really strong finish in California, which has 475 delegates that are allocated by the voting, with him only 290 behind, if he got 475, a majority of those did well in New Jersey and these other states, that he could pull ahead of her and have a plurality of delegates based on the actual election and then try to use that to get the superdelegates to switch. But now what has happened with them coming out and saying that it was all over, that Hillary had won it, I'm sure it didn't help him at all. Right now we're looking at Hillary Clinton in New Jersey having 61% and Bernie Sanders having 38%. So that's not helping him there in New Jersey. So it'd be interesting to talk to the people in California, ask them what they think about that early pronouncement from the AP, ask them if they think Bernie's going to get out, why or why not, and what they think about this whole superdelegate process.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's interesting, too, to see the amount of people that are more passionate for him. I mean, you can't walk up and down the street. Like, I've got a guy that's got a very offensive shirt on right behind me, you know, that that has Hillary's face on it. And yet everyone comes up and cheers. And, you know, and the guy that's holding my camera right now, Alonzo, he's got a Hillary for Prison t-shirt. We're walking up and down Venice Beach, and people are cheering that on. No one likes her. I don't understand how this is even happening like that. How can she even be here? You know, but there are those hardcore Hillary fans out there that, you know, they live by that whole, what difference does it make? What difference does it make about Benghazi or the emails or any of the other scandals that she's been involved in, or her husband, or her covering up for it? You know, that's one thing, like I said, that both sides here can come to an agreement on, is that she doesn't belong there. She belongs in, you know, in prison, yeah, in San Quentin, Clinton for San Quentin.
Well, you know, this is what it's about, Joe. I saw one of the headlines that said, Hillary Clinton is about to become the first female nominee for president. And I looked at that and I said to my wife, women can do better than that. I don't want to, if I was women, as I was a woman, I would not be happy about that. I would not want to be represented as part of a group where she is the representative of that. Certainly women can do better than having Hillary Clinton be their first female candidate for president.
But we shouldn't even be talking about having a female president that represents women. She is above that then. You know, this should be a presidential candidate who represents all American people. And yet I watched her speech earlier today, and all she's talking about, you know, this is going to be a historic day. I'm going to be the first female president, blah, 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 blah. Like, come on. It has nothing to do with your gender. We don't want someone who's going to do the job right. I'm ready for a female president. I don't mind, but I do not think that she is the right person for that. And all you have to do is look at her track record to figure that out.
And she's not the right person because she makes it about being a female. That's precisely what you're saying there. And that's what we've seen in terms of this discussion about what should be a discussion about La Raza, but is being spun by the Republicans and the establishment media and the Democrats as Donald Trump's racism. No, what we saw when we, and we mentioned this earlier, Drudge had a flashback to when Sotomayor was coming in as a Supreme Court justice, and she said, no, I'm going to, as a wise Latina, I am going to make a different decision than a white male would, and that's a better thing. So she's selling the fact that she is Hispanic, that she's female, whatever, and that's what Hillary is about. It's not like, I'm going to be the best president, I'm going to do what's in the best interest of America, I'm going to represent all people. No, it's simply about women. And notice the way Hillary responded to all these attacks on Donald Trump and this judge's bias. She said, well, the next thing, he's going to be coming after women. I mean, again, it's about women.
They keep trying to sell this narrative, because I can't remember who was it that said that there's a special place in hell for women who don't support each other.
Yeah, that's right. That was that Gloria Steinem or Barbara Boxer? It was one of the
Nancy Pelosi?
I can't remember.
One of those.
That's a trivia question of the night. Albright. Okay, so my hat.
All right, there Albright. We go.
There you go.
It was one of those establishment women feminists. So, yeah, but that's true. Yeah, special place in hell for them.
I mean,
and, of course, it was
a
problem when they killed the children.
She is the queen of pandering. You know, depending on what part of the country she's in, she changes her accent. You know, she's on a hip-hop radio show, and she goes, you know, they ask her what she carries around in a purse. She goes, oh, I carry hot sauce. So I'm like, come on.
That was ridiculous.
You're ridiculous. Right? I love women. Like, oh, yeah, you love women. That's why you're guarding Bill from all the rape allegations he's got. Yeah, you really care about women. You're giving money to Saudi Arabia or taking money to Saudi Arabia. Yeah, you care about women. Come on. Let's be real here.
Yeah, she's a total fraud. Well, Joe, so you'll be checking back in with us as you talk to the people they're assembling to hear Bernie Sanders tonight in California. Is that right?
Yes, I will be checking back in with Marcos and finding out whenever you guys are ready to have me on.
Okay.
I'm going to go through and start talking to some of these people, and then eventually, hopefully, we can try to get side as well.
All right. Thank you very much. That's Joe Biggs in California. And we also have our other reporter in California, Leanne McAdoo, is ready to join us. Leanne.
Hi, David. Yes, as a woman, I have to agree with you there. I think we can do a lot better than Hillary Clinton.
Oh, yeah.
Why does she have to be our first female president? And she's under an FBI investigation. She's got a trail of dead following behind her. She covers up her husband's rape allegations. She's not for women. I mean, I agree. We can do better.
Yeah, it absolutely is amazing. But I know you have not heard what Donald Trump did. I think he gave, when we cut in, heard some of the best of his speech. The portion that I heard was the best speech that I've heard Donald Trump give, because he said, I'm not going to give up on this. I'm not going to compromise on these integrity issues. And he said, because I'm in this for the country. You know what? If he's going to compromise on this issue just so that he can do it for political gain, then he's going to compromise on every issue that comes down the line. And when I heard him say that, and when I heard him put it in those terms, that made me feel a lot better about Donald Trump. I think this is going to be a huge win for him, because people are beginning to understand now that this judge isn't simply somebody who was born in Indiana, as Newt Gingrich and Paul Ryan and these other people are spinning it. This is a guy who self-identifies with La Raza, which is the Hispanic Ku Klux Klan. Let's call them La KKK. That's what they really are, La Ku Klux Klan.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. And we can't forget that we've got Hillary Clinton palling around with the two guys whose mom was one of the founding members of La Raza. So they're definitely infiltrating the ranks and getting in there to make some major changes. And what we're seeing here in California, it was in the LA Times today, that they're actually seeing a mass number of Latinos going nonpartisan, and they're not choosing the Democratic or the Republican Party, which just goes to show you that by the left flooding the country with people who don't have any allegiance, thinking that they're going to do that and these people are going to vote Democrat because they're going to want the welfare state. They made a big mistake there, because when those people do get their opportunity, their chance, their allegiance is to themselves, not to this country.
Well, let's hope that's true. I think where they're going to have the most success in creating minions, however, is through the university system. And that's whether they're coming in from a foreign country or whether they're native-born Americans whose parents were American. They know that if they can get them through that university system, then they're theirs. If they keep them from kindergarten through graduate school, forget it. These people aren't going to escape that mind trap that they've laid for them. And that's why Hillary and Bernie are pushing so hard to make sure that it's free tuition. But it's going to be the downfall of the country. We can't have open borders and free tuition for anybody who wants to come here and study in the language of their choice. It's absolute insanity. I've never heard anything more detached from reality. But I want to ask you, because we've got Richard Reeves on the line to talk to us from New Jersey. It looks like you're standing in front of a school. Is that a polling place there that you are at?
Yeah, we've been through several polling locations today, and we did actually end up finding a place where Hillary Clinton voters are. We're here in West Hollywood. It's a super liberal part of Hollywood, and it was kind of even between her and Bernie. Didn't get anyone that was voting for Trump out of here, although we did have a few people that kind of shirked away and didn't want to admit who they voted for, and we could kind of look
identify them as Trump supporters.
They're Trumpers because they're afraid.
Yeah.
And even with people who were voting for Bernie or Hillary, that even they're a little bit ashamed, embarrassed to admit. I just think everyone's, a little disappointed in our first female president that they are forcing upon us.
So did you get anybody to, you said you did get some people to admit that they voted for Hillary?
Yeah, we took an anonymous poll here kind of off camera. Mm-hmm. We do have a few people that we got earlier today, but we just didn't want to scare them right out of the polling location. But we will, once I cut out with you, we're going to upload a few reports. But yeah, they did admit there were big time Hillary supporters and a lot of people very disappointed in the fact that they're here in California and their votes don't actually count because they were told this morning that Hillary is in.
Mm-hmm. See, that's a key thing. That's a key thing for the Bernie people. Did you mention that to the Bernie people? Did they were they the ones that were really upset about that?
They were very upset about it, but they came anyway, and people are still expecting and hoping for some sort of an upset to say, you know what, maybe he will win here, and maybe he will be able to prove to those superdelegates that he might have a shot, and perhaps they can come over to the other side. But that would be truly historical, and I don't see it happening, but it's not really, that really wasn't his agenda. I don't think Bernie ever planned on becoming president. He just wanted to push the party even further to the left, and I think he's succeeded in doing that.
Well, I think he's going to succeed at the convention. He's going to come into that convention from a position of strength, and she's going to feel whether she offers him the vice presidency or whatever else. He is going to dictate a lot of terms in terms of the platform and in terms of pulling her further to the left. It's going to make it even harder for her to win the election because then she's going to be a hardcore leftist along with all of her integrity and criminality issues as well. Do we have time? We've got Richard Reeves in New Jersey. Do we have time, Marcos, to go to Richard before we go to break?
Yeah, we're going to break at 8:58 here.
All right.
We'll get him on and we'll hold him over.
Okay. Leanne, anything real quickly you want to tell us before we go to Richard to sum up? And are we going to be talking to you later?
Yeah, we'll have some reports coming your way. We're going to get some people coming out of the polling locations and find out, you know, how do they feel about the fact that their votes don't count. And we're going to try and attend this Hillary Clinton after party. So
all 10 of you.
That's going to be so fun. That should be a lot of fun. Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll check in for the festivities. Thank you so much, Leanne McAdoo in California. Let's go now to Richard Reeves in New Jersey. Richard.
All right, David, thank you. Well, from one side of the country to the other.
That's right.
I tell you, and I'm here to echo basically what Leanne was saying, that it is difficult to, at these polling locations to find people that are willing to admit to being Trump voters. Most of them, they're not going to tell you. And it seems like people are more willing to admit that, hey, I want to vote for Bernie, or I have voted for Bernie, I have voted for Hillary. It does seem like that's a lot easier task, but
They've been told by the media that that's okay. And even when they do the public opinion polling, you know, where they call people up, they said, well, we know that these results are a bit skewed because people are even afraid to admit to somebody over the telephone that they are a Trump supporter. I mean, certainly after what we've seen in California, if you've got a Trump T-shirt on, you might be hunted down and beaten up. That's what we saw at all these rallies. So I can understand people doing it. They're afraid for their safety. It's not just that they are afraid that people are going to say nasty things to them.
Exactly. And, they're worried that, since they may not be familiar with InfoWars, in some cases, they're thinking, well, this left-stream media here, they're going to harpoon me on their program and make me look like an idiot. So
that's right.
That's another thing. But anyway, Donald Trump just spoke here, as you guys were showing on the broadcast earlier. And one key thing, I don't know if you guys have discussed it yet, but one key thing that he said a lot of key things, but one of them that really caught my attention is how that he said that Hillary Clinton used the State Department as her own private hedge fund.
Yes, great quote.
So the gloves are so off. The gloves are so off. And, you know, he announced that next Monday or Tuesday, somewhere early next week, he's going to have another press conference. And I think he's going to be just like a WWE wrestler, like The Rock or Steve Austin or Triple H or somebody like that. And he's going to lay the smack down on Hillary's candy hind end.
That's right. He's not even going to wait for the nomination formalities at the convention. He's going on it next week. That's the amazing thing. The other thing that I heard, we didn't hear all of it, Richard, but one of the things that I thought was very key when we first came in, he was talking about how he was not going to compromise on this issue, just as he's not going to compromise on other issues. In other words, if he's going to compromise on these personal integrity issues that are affecting him right now, if he was that kind of a person, like a Paul Ryan, like a Mitch McConnell, like all these establishment politicians, then he's going to compromise for political gain on other issues that are going to be important to the general public. And I thought that was a very effective statement that he made and something that really, I think, spoke well of his integrity. He's taking a lot of heat for the way he worded this. And I wish that he had mentioned the fact that this judge was La Raza and not just said Mexican heritage, because Newt Gingrich and the rest of these guys are saying, hey, he's from Indiana. Newt Gingrich says, well, if you come to America, you get to be an American citizen. It's like, well, actually, Newt, we need to have a discussion about that, don't we? But go ahead, Richard.
And as Alex was talking about here in previous broadcasts, saying that I think Trump just instinctively does it where he just lays some raw meat out, he lays some bait out, he waits for the sharks of the mainstream NWO-controlled media to come in, and then he eviscerates them. So I think that's what's going to happen. They think they're going to come in, a bunch of hungry sharks coming in for a baby whale, and all of a sudden they're going to be facing, killer whale Donald Trump. So,
the bottom line is that he's right on this issue, Richard, just like he was right on the issue when the Washington Post did that hit piece on him, trying to show him as a sexual predator. And they misconstrued, they took out of context, they implied motives to these women that they came back and held press conferences and said, they took my words out of context. I was very complimentary of Donald Trump. I had absolutely no problem with the way that he treated me. Or in one case, she said, I wrote a book. They took out of context the paragraph there, right down on that same page. I said great things about Donald Trump. They didn't report that. I told them I didn't even want to talk to them. So they went back and they took quotes out of her book and took them out of context to attack him. So all that stuff blew up in their face. And now we've had for several days, we've had all these Republicans coming out here. We've had a guy who's running in Illinois unendorse Donald Trump, saying, I'm going to distance myself from Donald Trump. And they're going to be left hung out to dry because people are going to look at what this judge did in terms of releasing that. He released all of this private conversation because the Washington Post, with their army of 20-plus reporters who are going to invent stuff about Donald Trump, wanted it from this judge. So he said, sure, here it is. And, you know, as I was coming in here, I just heard the State Department say they're not going to comply with the FOIA requests and the legal requests for Hillary Clinton's email information from the State Department for 75 years. 75 years. They're going to take that long. And yet this judge turned this over immediately to these people. That shows an incredible bias. And he was simply talking about what motivates this judge. Besides his political bias, he also has a bias because he's in the race, La Raza, La Ku Klux Klan.
Absolutely. Well, and every time things like this have happened, it's always ended up being in Donald Trump's favor. He's always boomeranged it back. So we can
because he's been right.
Expect that. Yeah. Right, exactly. He's been right. And so we can expect that to happen again. And above all that, you know, mixed in with that is, you know, how he just keeps burning the press. The NWO, mainstream, lamestream, controlled press just keeps destroying itself, keeps showing it to be liars. I mean, that's something that the American people, the ones that are in the know about the globalist conspiracy that we've got going on, they've been fighting the mainstream press for years that have been dictating us, you know, who's going to be the president, who are going to be the nominees, who's going to be
Richard.
Your congressman.
We've got to go to break, Richard. We're going to hang on. We've got to take a break. We're going to be right back with Richard Reeves, another one of our reporters. He's reporting from New Jersey. He was just there at the Donald Trump press conference. We'll be right back with Richard Reeves, with Jakari Jackson, and I'm David Knight. Stay with us.
This message is not just addressed to my fellow Americans, but addressed to people across the world of every race, color, and creed who believe in free speech, enshrined here in our republic as the First Amendment. It's the First Amendment to Bill of Rights because it is the most important. The right to speak, the right to publish, the right to assemble, the right to petition, the right to practice your own religion and not having a state-run or authorized system. We have seen Facebook, Google, Twitter, and other media platforms increasingly censor even mainline libertarian and conservative ideas. Ladies and gentlemen, Facebook, if it's able to successfully get away with censoring a wide spectrum of ideas that the establishment doesn't agree with, not just conservatives, will set a mega massive precedent. Facebook's over a third of the internet. Just think about that, of the traffic and people visiting things. And then it's over. You think it's bad that communist China, with 1.3 billion people, is censoring? Zuckerberg, who calls his users dumb effers, has been meeting with the Chinese censorship leadership openly. openly trying to tweak it. He met with Merkel and openly in a hot mic said, don't worry, I'm going to start suppressing and censoring people. They report when someone criticizes open borders to the German government and they come and arrest you. This is a global phenomenon that's taking place right now. They're passing laws in Canada to arrest people that criticize transgender. Well, that's your free speech. It's not hate propaganda, as they call it. If they set the precedent on these issues, they will basically ban any other type of speech that the globalists don't want. This is the ultimate threat to humanity. This is worse than what we saw in the Soviet Union. This is right out of Nazi Germany or right out of Maoist China. So we're fighting for free speech. When you spread the word about InfoWars.com, our videos, our stories, our reports, and when you post it on different platforms, that circumvents their AI systems that are trying to restrict the flow of information. We stand together or we hang separate. Another thing we're doing is not just battling to stop the censorship, we're also building other platforms, getting on as many third-party systems as there are out there and spreading the word of basic free market liberty and human empowerment and the new renaissance. But also, the experts I've talked to said, Alex, you missed the boat. You've been a pioneer in many ways, but you haven't promoted email. And I said, yeah, I don't ever really market on email. I just, it's low tech. And they're like, no. That's what's going to be hard to censor. Even if the internet kill switch comes into place, there are systems and there are developments that make it very hard still to stop email and to stop that information being sent over networks, you name it. So it's essential that everybody go to InfoWars.com/newsletter to get exclusive articles, videos, promo codes sometimes, the shopping cart like we had a few weeks ago with Hillary for prison, 50% off. I mean, there are some big discounts we send to incentivize people, and plus you're some of the most hardcore patriots. You can send the email and the newsletter on with exclusive videos and articles many days. So that's another great reason. But overall, it's so that we have direct contact with fellow patriots out there around the world. And if they try to start shutting our websites down and other things, which they tried to do, and kick us off Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, you name it, we'll be able to send you direct videos that you can then send on to others. We've all got to start thinking about the censorship and actively fighting it, getting more active and not taking independent, liberty-based media for granted, which I know you don't do, but really having a sense of urgency and getting the info out more while building new avenues on cutting-edge tech and cutting-edge platforms, but also old tech like email. So please join hundreds of thousands of others that have been signing up every few months at InfoWars.com/newsletter. And you can also spread the word about our free feeds and more podcasts, Droid apps, iPhone apps. It's all free at InfoWars.com/show.
InfoWars Nightly News live coverage of the final set of six presidential primaries. And you just saw those states count down there on the graphic as we were coming in with a lead-in. We've had results from New Jersey, where Hillary Clinton has won that by a large margin. And we also have results from the next group of states, North Dakota, South Dakota, and New Mexico. Now, South Dakota and New Mexico both went for Hillary, about the same amount. 54 to 46 in both states at this point. They haven't called it for Hillary, but she has a very large lead at this point. In North Dakota, however, it was the opposite. Bernie won resoundingly in North Dakota. Bernie Sanders won North Dakota 63% to 24%. They have called that for Bernie Sanders. Now with me is Jakari Jackson, and we have our reporter Richard Reeves in New Jersey. And Jakari Jackson had a couple of questions for you, Richard.
Yeah, before I ask my question to Richard, we won't give out the call number. It is 1-877-789-ALEX. That is 1-877-789-2539. We'll be taking your calls here just in a little bit. Now, Richard, I know one of the hot topics that's been going on with Trump is that of Newt Gingrich. As David and I were discussing a little bit earlier in the broadcast, we were both very surprised when we saw Newt early in the campaign for Trump, come out and say these very nice things. We weren't exactly sure why he was doing that. And as David said, that you have to get behind somebody before you can stab them in the back. And now we see this report from Kit Daniels here today talking about how Trump refused a reported $200 million to pick Gingrich as his VP. So with this in mind, do you have any idea who Trump might pick as his VP?
Well, I would have to look into some more on that. You know, some people said somebody like Jeff Sessions. I know that there's the woman governor of Oklahoma and New Mexico that have been rumored about. But, you know, this deal on Newt Gingrich, that's such a big deal. That's a huge deal. I mean, they've been talking about that the Republican campaign for president and the other race, that they're talking about that they need $1 billion. And here was Sheldon Adelson saying that, hey, $200 million, commit to have Newt Gingrich as the VP, and Trump says no, thank you. So how huge is that? That's just so big that he did that. And that's one thing that I've been watching for months is Newt Gingrich. We've seen him on Fox, on O'Reilly, on Kelly, on Hannity, cozying up, being friendly, being the New World Order good cop. I remember Newt Gingrich back from the 90s. He was supposed to come in and try to help roll back NAFTA and GATT. You know, made these promises, the contract with America, and we had gained some ground, but it's typical New World Order fashion. Two steps forward with their agenda, one step back, and Newt Gingrich was the one step back for the NWO agenda back in the mid-90s, 94, 96 era. But, you know, did he take it all the way? Did he carry the football? No, he was there to be the steam valve to take that Republican fervor that was up during that time that was looking at protecting, you know, our national interests, especially with regard to trade. I mean, in 1992, David, I'm sure you remember, NAFTA and GATT, that election was really about NAFTA and GATT back then, because that's when Ross Perot popped up.
Al Gore on Larry King, I remember that very well, yeah.
Absolutely, it was huge. You know, Ross Perot kept talking about that giant sucking sound, you know. So it's just incredible that here we are again. We're facing Newt Gingrich. He's trying to come in. But I think Donald Trump's smarter than that. And I tell you, I mean, that really proves it right there. He's turning down $200 million. They're telling him he needs $1 billion to have a chance to win against Hillary. Well, I tell you what, either, you know, Trump needs to keep working his magic with getting all that publicity. He had $1 or $2 billion worth of in-kind press in the primaries. I think he can do that all over again. But we can also look that the NWO-controlled mainstream press, you know, this past Sunday on the Talking Head shows, Meet the Press, George Snuffleupagus, all those programs, they started with the Hillary Clinton Love Fest 2 days early, already saying, oh, how wonderful she did last week when she came out attacking Trump. You know, they didn't talk about her like Trump, like when Trump was attacking somebody else. Oh, how horrible. Oh, how uncouth. Oh, how bigoted. Oh, how racially motivated. Oh, how this, that, and the other. No, Hillary did a fantastic job attacking Trump, according to them. Yeah. So, yeah, the mainstream media, NW control media, and Newt Gingrich, all people we have to watch out for. And you saying that you got to get behind somebody before you can stab him in the back, that is perfect to describe Newt Gingrich at this point. And now here's a couple of dangers about the RNC convention. I think basically after tonight, Trump is going to have such an overwhelming batch of delegates that pretty much it's almost fumble-proof at the July RNC. And that's one thing I said back in January is, look, Trump needs to have 1,400 or better pledged delegates. That way he's got a big fudge factor. It makes it harder to steal when you got 1,400 instead of the 1,238. It just barely won over. And so he's going to have the 1,400. That makes it very hard to steal. But nonetheless, we still got to watch out in the convention because the honorary chairperson of that convention, the chairman, I don't want to be politically correct. I got to step back out of that. The chairman, the honorary chairman that's normally elected to the RNC convention, this circumstance is the Speaker of the House when he's a Republican.
Yeah.
So Paul Ryan is in line to be the chairman of the RNC convention, which gives him godlike powers. And then the rumor is the number two guy behind Paul Ryan, should the delegates reject Paul Ryan, which they should, well, then step in Newt Gingrich potentially. So we need to have a wild card.
Wait a minute, Richard. I got to ask you this. Why would Newt Gingrich be the second alternate? Wouldn't they have like the whip or the leader or something like that?
Well, it's just like any election. Basically, the delegates got to choose, who's going to be our chairman? look for that to potentially be a very contested thing. It, it may go smoothly. It may go perfectly. They may day one, boom, it just, boom, they take Paul Ryan. I don't trust Paul Ryan, but the delegates may do that. It's possible. I'd look for it to be challenged, though. And so why they would do that is because Newt Gingrich has that experience being former Speaker of the House. So he knows how to run these meetings. He knows about the they run those on House rules, the conventions. And so he's experienced in that regard. So he's kind of the natural person, you know, and worse than that would be John Boehner. So potentially anybody, you know, Reince Priebus could be the chairman. I think he'd be potentially as I'm not a big fan of Reince Priebus, but I think he would be more fair in that position than a Paul Ryan or Newt Gingrich. So we really need to look at that. Who's going to be the chairman of that convention? Because, David, that is godlike power that is given to that person running the convention. He can say, you know, is Donald Trump our nominee, yay or nay? And the yays have it in reality, but he can say, oh, the nays have it. You know, yeah. That's how much power they have. And then they'll call for a roll call vote. But, you know, you just can't trust them. They're going to have probably electronic voting on the floor going on there at the RNC in Cleveland. So watch out. That's probably the one wild card piece of the RNC that potentially could wreak havoc is who's going to be chairman at that convention.
Wow.
Ryan and Gingrich are right in line.
And of course, Richard, I think one of the key things people need to pay attention to, and this really should be a national concern. We have Paul Ryan coming up for his primary in August. And you're talking about him opposing Donald Trump at the convention. He's going to be the major opposition to Donald Trump if Donald Trump were to become President Trump. He is going to be opposing his nationalist agenda to stop this globalist ripping off of our economy, looting of our economy, and to do something about the open borders. He opposes Trump on all of those issues, and he will oppose him as Speaker of the House. It's going to be very difficult to get anything through. I think people, it's possible, we always need to take a look at this, it is possible to get Paul Ryan out. We do have a candidate there challenging him who supports Donald Trump, who opposes the TPP. Hopefully people will get behind that and do something, because that is a key strategic move if we're going to get anything done with a President Trump, is to get Paul Ryan out of his Speaker of the House position. Get him out of Congress completely. It's time for him to go.
Absolutely. David, we need to see Paul Ryan lose that chairmanship of the RNC in July. We need to see Paul Ryan lose his House seat in the primary in August in Wisconsin. Never forget, folks, never forget what happened in Wisconsin. In Wisconsin, that was the peak of the Never Trump movement, and Paul Ryan was one of the top motivators and drivers. He was quiet, but he rounded up Scott Walker. He rounded up all that support for Ted Cruz and to try to thwart the Donald Trump train, and he didn't succeed. So Paul Ryan, ultimately, he got that small victory in Wisconsin, but he went down to defeat in the big Never Trump movement. And so now we need to see him be defeated in July at the RNC, August in his House primary. And so, you know, you're right, David. He is absolutely going to be blocking and thwarting what happens in the House with Donald Trump as president if he stays in that position. And to show that and to further demonstrate that, all we have to think back is, in December, when Paul Ryan basically gave President Barack Obama everything he ever dreamed for in the omnibus bill.
Yeah, absolutely. Your feed is breaking up a little bit, Richard, and we want to take some of the callers who have called in. Thank you so much. We got Richard Reeves in New Jersey. And if anything comes up there, just contact us again and let us know what's happening. We've been talking to our correspondents. Thank you so much, Richard. We've been talking to our correspondents in California, Leanne McAdoo. Joe Biggs will be joining us again later. And, of course, Rob Dew even called us at 3 a.m. in the morning in Dresden, Germany, where he's covering Bilderberg, and he may be getting evicted early in the morning because they found out that he's a reporter covering Bilderberg. He's booked through tomorrow, but he got a thing saying that if he doesn't get out by noon, exit may not be possible.
That's right.
And who knows what that means.
Also, in studio, we have Kit Daniels.
Yeah, yeah. Should we go to Kit? Let's go to Kit, and then we'll go to our first caller. Kit, you want to comment on your story today about Newt Gingrich and them offering the golden handcuffs to Donald Trump?
Yeah, one point I want to make about the whole Newt Gingrich scandal is the fact that Donald Trump completely destroyed the establishment in the campaign. You know, he's got like, what, a 100% war score. He can demand their unconditional surrender. So, you know, he has absolutely no reason for them to decide who, you know, he's going to take as a vice presidential pick. And in fact, I pointed this out in the article, you know, Alex and I kind of worked on it with the insider, but this is something I kind of figured out on myself, is the fact that it would be in his best interest to pick someone like Jeff Sessions or someone who's ideologically more in line with Trump, because if they put in someone like a Paul Ryan, for example, just, you know, establishment candidate, or Newt Gingrich, they could easily go in there and assassinate Trump, and then they could put in whoever, you know, the establishment candidate into the White House. And also, you know, like I said about Reagan, even though they didn't kill Reagan, he still was, he got in line with this, the globalist policies, many of them, after his assassination attempt, because, you know, he saw Vice President Bush the entire time he was left, he was in office. Now he got assassinated, what, 1981, and, you know, from then on out, he was constantly reminded that the establishment was watching his every step. So it would be Trump, it would be in his very best interest to take in Sessions or someone else that's more aligned with him ideologically than an establishment candidate. And also, David, I'm doing something a little bit different tonight. I'm taking questions on my Facebook page, Real Kit Daniels. And I got this question in from Lenny. And it says, with all the third party potential candidates, which one do you suggest holds more threat to Donald Trump? A, Gary Johnson. B, Stein, which I believe is Green Party. C, a potential Sanders independent bid. Or D, none of the above. Hillary will be the main fight. Personally, I'm going to say D, because let's say Johnson, Gary Johnson, at this point, Trump's got a lot of libertarian voters. And then you got libertarian voters are anarchists. They're not going to vote for anybody. So I think right now, the only people who are really going to vote for Gary Johnson are hardcore Libertarian Party officials and whatnot. And Stein, I haven't heard anything about him on the campaign trail. I didn't even know who he was until I saw this Facebook post.
No, it's actually a female. Yeah, Stein is. She ran last time. Yeah.
And here's what's really interesting: potential Sanders independent bid. I think that would actually hurt Hillary more than Sanders, because all of Hillary's support that's currently Sanders is going to go to Sanders. Mm-hmm. And then some people that won't vote for Sanders as an independent bid, they're going to go to Trump. Like I said in the articles a couple of weeks ago, right now, like 50% of Sanders supporters would support Trump over Hillary, because, granted, Trump is a nationalist and, you know, Sanders is a socialist, but at least Trump is not a globalist. He's not a Wall Street financed, Occupy Wall Street kind of, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, you know, I think perhaps Gary Johnson may be a factor in this, but I don't think he's going to pull votes from Donald Trump unless people understand what his position is on the issues. He's not going to get any support at all from Donald Trump. He's not going to be very appealing to conservatives or to lowercase libertarians. And he's working very hard to try to get the Bernie Sanders people saying, hey, I'm like you guys. And, you know, quite frankly, he isn't. The key issue for the Bernie Sanders people is one of socialism. And he can't, no matter how hard he tries to embrace the LGBT issue, no matter how hard he tries to embrace all this political correctness and racialism of the Democrat Party, and that's what Gary Johnson's been doing, and no matter how much they try to move towards gun control, he still isn't going to get the Democrats. But he'll pull in more Democrats if he gets any votes. He'll pull in more Democrats than he will from Donald Trump, because he's taking those issues. If people look at the issues, and I see a lot of, and the reason I say that he might have some effect is I see a lot of the never Trump Republican establishment pushing him seriously. And if they can push him to get him in the debate, he will make an issue out of being in the debate. That'll be
Devil's advocate, the only thing Gary Johnson is doing right now is the same thing that everyone else has tried against Trump and failed to do, is try to paint Trump as racist and sexist and whatnot. And Gary Johnson, I don't even think he's really that strong of a candidate, even regardless of his ideologically. You know, he's just this kind of this weird guy in a way. So
he's a very poor debater. If you looked at him in those debates, he was a very, very poor debater. A lot of non sequiturs, a lot of ridiculous analogies. And he doesn't have a very good demeanor. John McAfee pointed that out very bluntly. So I don't think he's going to be very strong if he does get into the debates. He might try to play the spoiler issue on it, but I don't really think he's got any issues. It's a real odd mix of issues. He's not going to appeal really to Democrats or Republicans if they look at him on the issues. He's basically thrown out Republican and Libertarian votes by embracing political correctness and the LGBT agenda over private property and throwing the Second Amendment under the bus. Absolutely amazing. And these two guys, their big appeal is what? That they're career politicians. in a year when career politicians are not doing popular. Well. Exactly. So
It's funny. I'm reminded, David, that I think it was in Nebraska. Then Ted Cruz said on the Glenn Beck show that, you know, if he happened to win the primary, he didn't re-enter the race. Yeah. And to me, it's funny. Yeah. I joked about saying, "Oh, it's a zombie Ted Cruz." Gary Johnson pretty much is zombie Ted Cruz right now. He's kind of got this zombie-ness about him, and how he's very uncomfortable about who he is, and he's kind of this creep factor. He's attacking Trump just like Ted Cruz did.
He's thrown out a lot of the core anchor issues and principles of the Libertarian Party, and it's going to become, I think, the Gary Johnson Party, just like the Green Party has become the Jill Stein Party. You have a perpetual nominee that comes
Ralph
there,
Nader
and that's what
party.
They do. Exactly. They take it over. Thanks. I want to get to, that's Kit Daniels, one of our reporters there taking questions on Facebook. I want to get to some of our callers now. Which one do you want to take?
I'll give out the number again. It is 1-877-789-ALEX. That is 1-877-789-2539. We'll go ahead and we'll start with Scott in Washington. Scott, you want to talk about Newt Gingrich?
I'm going to hit three things real quick, but I wanted to correct you on something because everybody keeps talking about that Hillary would be the first female nominee. Actually, technically, she wouldn't be. Cynthia McKinney got that title in 2008.
Okay, what party was that? Was that a third party?
It was the Green Party.
Oh, okay.
And actually her running mate was a female, Rosa Clemente. So
okay.
I guess that'd be a good thing to bring up to all the Hillary supporters.
Yeah, there you go. You can take some of the wind out of their sails. Of course, I think a lot of people are looking at this. Green Party has done well in some states, but they have not been able to get ballot access on a lot of different states. And that's one of the key things about the Libertarian Party that made them attractive for globalist establishment figures to take them over. They have gotten very good at getting 50-state ballot access. So that is likely going to happen this time as well. But go ahead, your comments on Gingrich.
Yeah, well, I got actually my own little story about the Libertarian Party, but I'll talk about that some other time. But yeah, I am glad to see that he is not considering the demonic Pillsbury Doughboy as his running mate.
Isn't that good news? I said that Sunday when I saw it. I said, boy, this is really good news. Gingrich is stabbing him in the back. I am so happy to see that because that means that the meetings that they had did not go well. You know, we had Margaret Thatcher go to the Bilderberg thing once, and she said, you know, she was very critical when she came out of it. And within the year, they had an internal party revolution and pushed her out and put in Majors as prime minister. So, you know, just because somebody meets with a Newt Gingrich or meets with a CFR figure like Richard Haass doesn't mean that they've been co-opted by them. And so I saw that as a very positive sign that Gingrich started attacking him. Go ahead.
And let us not forget, you know, those commercials he did a few years back holding hands with good old Nazi Pelosi and Reverend Mac Daddy over at MSNBC telling us about global warming and all of that.
That's right. Yeah, I forgot about that. Selling global warming too. Yeah.
No to that. But I'll say a quick thing about Bernie Sanders that would stop him from a third party run. Number one, it's too late for him to get ballot access.
That's right.
Number two, he doesn't have the money. And number three, that I think that there's an ace that they're going to probably play against him as far as him even getting any play at the convention, is that his wife may very well be indicted, and he could very well be looking at indictment himself, considering if he had any role in that university debacle up there in their state. So,
yeah, isn't that interesting? He's got his own university problem, doesn't he? And it's a much more serious problem than Donald Trump. I mean, they're saying that, well, his sale pitch was a little bit too strong. And the person who brought the charges initially dropped out of the lawsuit. And that's one of the complaints that Donald Trump has. You know, this judge is biased. He should have let that case go because the main plaintiff here dropped out. And so it just keeps going. But, yeah, this is far more serious for Bernie Sanders, and Hillary Clinton's got her own university scandal as well.
Yeah, because Jan Sanders, from the way that I read that, is, I know that they're federally investigating her. She may be indicted. So,
Well, that's interesting. I'd not heard that there might be an indictment. I knew that she destroyed a university system.
Yeah.
And I know that Bernie Sanders' free tuition would destroy not only this country, but it would make tuition so expensive. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. We got a lot of callers, so I want to move on. Let's go to the next caller.
Yeah, we have Richard in Arizona. Go ahead, Richard.
Yeah, David and Jakari, and you guys are doing a fantastic job, and all the people you have in the field, I really appreciate it.
Well, thank you for your support.
Yeah, you've had it for, 16 years or something. But
thank you.
Anyway, the reason I'm calling in is because of a comment that you were making earlier. I would have liked to then, but you weren't taking calls yet, and you were talking about libertarians sometimes having bad judgment and wanting everything to be totally unrestricted in trade because it seems like an ideal. And I wanted to make an analogy, if I could.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times, Alex and other people on your team will say, well, they're killing all these people with vaccines, but it's because of the adjuvant. And it's not, and don't worry, it's not because we don't think the vaccine theory is good. We just want clean vaccines. But the reality, since this is a field I know a lot about, is that vaccines from day one were killing a lot of people and causing terrible epidemics. And when you relate that to free trade, so in other words, there's no such thing as a real clean vaccine. That's a myth.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as free trade goes, even the most idealistic pure free trade is only good for one thing, and that's to move more quickly toward a world economy and a world government. And if there's no way to preserve domestic industry without protective tariffs, and the fact that they've made protectionism some kind of a bad buzzword is highly misleading. It's absolutely essential. And unless you get rid of all the free trade agreements and make it impossible to make things in slave labor countries and bring them in here tariff-free, then domestic industry will never come back.
You know, I agree with you, because we talk about... Well, take Thomas Jefferson, for example, okay? Libertarians love Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson did not have free trade. Thomas Jefferson said in his second inauguration, he said, we have eliminated useless offices, and we've been able to reduce the size of government, and we have eliminated all internal taxation. They didn't have an income tax to get rid of. They eliminated all forms of internal taxation. He says, what farmer, what laborer, what mechanic knows a tax man? And, of course, that was a rhetorical question. They didn't. They didn't know who. They didn't have to pay taxes to the federal government. All of the federal government, when it's run at a constitutional size, could be funded off of trade tariffs at the border. And it's interesting, I think, if we go back and we look at the history of the income tax, when they imposed the income tax, and at the beginning it was a very small tax, only on the upper 1%. They were really the only people who paid any taxes of any amount, just the 1%. When they enacted the income tax, what did they do? They used it to cut tariff trades. So, why don't we just say, let's cut the income tax completely. Let's put taxes on goods coming in the border. Let's have a free trade within America. We don't have free trade within American borders because we're not allowed, for example, in healthcare, insurance companies can't compete across state lines. How does the federal government support something like that? The federal government and the Commerce Clause, which they use all the time to intrude themselves into every aspect of our life, the Commerce Clause was there specifically to prohibit any kind of trade barriers and any kind of services or goods within America. And yet we have insurance companies who cannot sell insurance across state lines. But we got all these other mandates from Obama. So I agree with you. I think that in general, I understand we should have a free market. And when they try to extend that outside of the national borders, I think you're right. I think we do start heading down the road to a global governance, and I think we need to maintain a low-tax, small government with free trade inside American borders, and we can fund the government off of the tariffs of goods that are coming into this country. That, I think that creates a strong America. It creates a vital, we have everything within this country that we need in terms of skills and in terms of natural resources to do anything that we want, but we are losing all of that know-how. We're losing that manufacturing base, and it is atrophying and dying as it's being exported abroad. And so, when we have Gary Johnson say, hey, the argument we've always heard, hey, the Chinese are going to produce free stuff for us, I say, bring it on. And what has it done to us? It's turned us into hopeless dependence.
Yeah, you can still get things from other countries, but not for less than it costs to produce the same thing here.
That's right. That's right. And to what extent? I mean, when we look at the robots taking everybody's jobs, we say, well, okay, that's great, but who's going to buy their products when nobody has any jobs? And that's the situation that we have here in America. If we're going to have these, have all of the wealth creation, and that's what we're talking about, manufacturing, that is the heart of your economy. Yes, it's important to have a service economy, but a service economy without a manufacturing base to support it is a hollowed out economy that cannot survive and cannot prosper. I absolutely agree with you. Great call, but we've got to move on. Let's go to our next caller.
Yes, we have Quest in Florida. Thank you for calling, caller. Go ahead, Quest in Florida.
Hey, David Jakari, thanks for your guys' efforts. I think everybody at the InfoWars crew deserves a good round of applause. Thank you for what you guys do. Like Shark Week was a big deal with the Discovery Channel, I look forward to Bilderberg Week every year with InfoWars and your guys' coverage. I think it's awesome. So
it is like Shark Week, isn't it?
Yeah, it's replaced Shark Week. I tell you,
the predators as they swim in those luxury accommodations. Yeah,
it's the real sharks. It's the sharks with suits, right?
Yeah,
the sharks that want to control our society and enslave our children. So that's the way that I see it. But I really appreciate the coverage that you guys do. I'm a longtime supporter and buy many of the products that you guys have for sale. So I do what I can to support you guys. My question, and it's so funny, Mikhail Thalen already wrote an article about it last year, and I didn't see it, but Trump's bloodline ties into, related to Hillary Clinton. So as far as the elite are concerned, he's one of the club. He's a member of the bloodline. I'm just curious to your guys' thoughts about that.
Well, we can go back and we can look at genealogies. I got to say to you that regardless of what his genealogy is, I have never seen anybody that makes the establishment, Democrat, Republican, American, foreign, all of them, loathe him. They are very much afraid of him.
Mm-hmm.
And just as we see this whole thing going on with Gingrich and everything, I see that as a very positive sign. I see that as validating his credentials. And one of the things about Donald Trump, if you look at the interviews that he's had with people throughout the years, he clearly is more comfortable, and he said this, and you can see it in the way that he relates to people. You can see it in the way that he talks. He doesn't speak like these people. He doesn't speak like the 18th generation Harvard William Weld, the guy who's the VP candidate on the Libertarian Party ticket, the guy whose ancestor was one of the first graduating classes and so forth and so on. They have two buildings named after him. He's a very smooth talker. Trump is not a smooth talker. He's a straight talker. And he feels more comfortable with the everyday worker. He feels more comfortable with the construction worker at the site than he does with the Goldman Sachs banker. And so I think he identifies, regardless of what his heritage and so forth and so on is, and you don't have to go, so many people, we look at the original descendants, let's say, go all the way back to the Mayflower, okay? There are literally hundreds of thousands of descendants of each of those persons. So you don't have to go back too far if you've got a genealogy table to tie people together. I don't even know. I haven't looked at my genealogy.
Talking about genealogy, they do these pretty much with every presidential candidate where they link people, in these big groups like Obama's linked to, who was it? It was somebody he ran against. I can't remember off the top of my head, but basically.
Dick Cheney.
Yeah, basically. There's always somebody that's, not too far removed. So I am aware of those, but it's not something I take, to the bank.
And I don't know if Donald Trump cares.
It's just one data point for me. I don't put all my faith into it. My reasoning for bringing it up is just kind of talking about that and evaluating that and just kind of reflecting on that idea. I believe what the Bible says, don't put your faith in any man.
That's right.
But as far as Donald Trump is concerned, he seems very good. He seems legitimate. He's got his chops down for running for president by doing a lot of work on television and with the WWE. So I'm not putting anything against him. I support the guy, generally speaking. But like I said, I don't put faith in any man.
That's right. We'll just have to wait and see. All I'm saying is that so far, these early signs and these things that are happening, it looks good to me. And I'm feeling good about seeing Gingrich coming out and attacking him and seeing
Absolutely.
These people, these people who we know are we know them better, and we see how much they hate him and how much they lie about him. And that's a good sign. And I thought we're going to take a close look at his press conference, and we're going to play some clips, I'm sure, tomorrow on the radio show. And I think it was a very, very strong and sincere statement. I think he is very sincere on being concerned about what's happening in this country with trade. He spent his own money, a great deal, $100,000 on one ad in the New York Times like 20, 25 years ago to complain about what was happening with trade. I mean, this is something that he's been authentic on for decades. These are things that he's genuinely concerned about. And so when I see him coming in and saying, I'm not going to compromise for political gain on this issue about my integrity, I think that's a very strong thing. And I think he's right about it, and I think he's been right about these other issues. I think it's going to play out. Thank you so much for calling Quest, and thank you so much for your support. That helps us to make this possible for us to put all these reporters at Bilderberg and other places. Let's move on to our next caller.
Absolutely. Now, you guys were showing us something while we were talking to the caller about a Hillary press conference. Is that something that's still ongoing?
Yeah, okay. She's giving her her speech.
Okay. Right, okay. Well, maybe we can...
I'd rather talk to the caller.
Yeah, I was just curious.
Yeah, I was going to say, guys, you're really not missing anything. She's given her victory speech. Of course, the media spotlight is on her, but what should be the spotlight and what should be up front and center stage is the superdelegates, because they're the ones that are stealing this election for Hillary, you know? And a lot of people, they don't understand who the superdelegates are. And I'm here to tell you that they are the career politicians. Barack Obama, for example, is a superdelegate. Mm-hmm. He represents Illinois. Bill Clinton, he represents New York this year. He's also a superdelegate. So they're current presidents, former presidents, and vice presidents. They are congressmen, you know, members of Congress, Senate. Those are your superdelegates, ladies and gentlemen, the class establishment politicians.
Darren, we could call that crony democracy, couldn't we, and put the quotes around the democracy.
Well, speaking, and it was Joseph Stalin who said those what was his quote? The people who cast the votes decide nothing. The people who count the votes decide everything.
That's right. That's exactly it.
All right. And it's going to be interesting to see how this whole thing shakes out. These are the people, quite frankly, when we look at things like constitutional conventions that I don't want writing the next next constitution for us or amending it. And that's the same people that you see as the superdelegates, as the insiders with the Republican Party. Let's go to our next caller.
All right, let's go ahead. I have a caller from Wisconsin. I can't see it from here. Is it Habu in Wisconsin? Okay, Habu has dropped.
Yeah.
All right, let's go
ahead.
I have Lynn in Indiana.
Go ahead, Lynn.
Hello, how are you?
Doing very good. Well. How are you?
Very well.
Thank you for calling.
Very good. Both of you are sharp-dressed.
Oh, thank you.
Patriotic men. I'm happy to see you tonight. And as a veteran, I want to say something. As a woman, I also want to say something. Number one, I went and saw 13 Hours a couple months ago.
Yes.
In a college town, and three of us gathered outside, and all of us were veterans, two men, me, a woman. We huddled together with wives standing around and my mother and cried. And other people who were not veterans were crying. At that moment, I realized Hillary needs to go to jail.
Yes.
And I was, in the Navy. And I went in 1992 when Bill Clinton became the president of the United States. And I'm here to tell you there needs to be a regime change, and it needs to be Donald Trump, because even if you don't like him, you have to see, and if you care for any veterans at all in your life, you have to see that he is truly going to be for the veterans. So if you have a brother or a sister and you are a liberal or you are a Democrat and you would never vote for Donald Trump, please, I'm just begging you, please just, from a veteran and a woman, you need to see what he's going to do for the veterans, because he is going to be the answer for us.
And I'm very refreshed to hear this, Lynn, as you say these words, because I run into so many women and they say they're going to vote for Hillary just for the fact that she's a woman, that they want to be a part of history. But as the caller already said, already had Cynthia McKinney, who was the first, a female presidential nominee. But I'm glad you came to this realization.
It's not even a realization. I honestly haven't really cared for, to be politically correct a little bit. I'll be nice. I haven't cared for Hillary ever. And to me, if you cannot see the forest through the trees when she gets up and speaks any words out of her mouth, I mean, I feel sorry for you, honestly, because you need to dig in deep and you need to see what the meat of the words coming out of her mouth are, and you need to see if you have Trump beside Hillary, truly, truly, who do you think is going to protect our country? And truly, who do you think is going to fight for our veterans. If you say Hillary, then you need to go back to sleep and wake up out of your dream.
You know, the other thing that I think is going to be very important, because what we saw in 13 hours was the absolute contempt for the lives of these people who had pledged their lives to protect America, America's interests, other Americans. Absolute contempt for them. And I think it's going to, the other thing, the other shoe that's going to drop is this Secret Service agent book that's going to be coming out, because the contempt with which she treats her own bodyguards, these people in the Secret Service who are there, who will take a bullet for these people because of the office, not because she's Hillary Clinton, but because of the office, because she was simply married to the president. And the contempt that she treated with them with, that they all say it was just unbelievable. They'd never seen anything like it. That is the kind of viciousness of this woman. And that's what makes her criminality possible, is that kind of detachment from humanity. It's a criminal pathology that she has. It isn't just that she made a mistake here or there. This woman is a sociopath, and she is cares nothing for the lives of even the people who have laid their lives down to protect her. And I think that's the key thing. That was a great film. The only thing I would change about it, they didn't need to make a statement about Hillary Clinton and what she was doing. I would have liked to have seen them. They called it 13 hours, and they kept showing the times there. I would have liked to have seen them put up, as they put up the time, to put the elapsed time, because we're sitting there the whole time saying, how many hours is this into this? You know, because it truly was amazing. Yes, you see it working out, and you see it changing, you know, from daytime to nighttime and so forth. And so you get the idea that a lot of time has passed. You know, that's a full 13 hours. But I think that would have been even more powerful. And certainly it would have been powerful if they would have brought Hillary in. But then it would have been just dismissed as some kind of
it had been polemic. Called a hit piece.
Yeah, exactly. So,
but it was a great film. Thank you so much, Lynn. We'll move on to our next caller. Let's go to CJ in Washington.
Hey, how you guys doing tonight?
Very well. Go ahead.
If you guys don't mind, I agree with a vast majority of the information you guys passed. I follow your guys' YouTube. It's how I got to watch the broadcast now. And one of the things that I wanted to bring up that apparently nobody seems to be bringing up is the family law reform movement that's growing in this country, specifically around the topic of Title IV reform. In Iowa, it was the number one question on RealClearPolitics.org website, and then it got pushed to the Concord, or the New Hampshire debate, and the Concord Monitor took the question, and they refused to answer the number one question. And I don't know if you guys can find it, but Real Clear Politics had. That is the number one question, is do you support family law reform and Title IV reform? To date, only a few of the candidates that answered are like Chris Christie. There was just a few of them. But
tell the audience what family law reform is specifically, because I'm assuming that you're talking about child protective services, but I'm not that familiar with the issue, quite frankly. So go ahead and tell the audience.
There's so many. Yeah, absolutely. There's so many problems when it comes to our family law court. I guess to break it down to family court 101 is that the government has set up rules for custody of children. And it's a very vicious game. There's many different branches. There's CPS. There's the court system itself. There's the attorneys, the state bar associations, all these interests in this gigantic $50 billion plus dollar a year industry. And it all revolves around how much child support can be ordered. If you look into the Title IV Funding Act of the Social Security Act, you'll see exactly what I'm talking about. So I'm not going to cover too much of it unless you want me to. But basically, it turns one parent into a visitor while the state can collect money on incentives through the Social Security Act. So any American that pays FICA, part of your money is going into this system. It's used for essentially taking away children from parents and producing visitors, not parents. And there's millions of people that are following right now the father's rights movement, parental equality movement is coming, you know, more out of the politically correct era from the father's rights movement. It's a little taboo to say father's rights movement, but what we're seeing is our judicial branch, and known as family law, is more of a court of equity and how much money you can afford to put out for an attorney. And meanwhile, like I said, it systematically destroys not only the individuals involved, but it also hurts our economy as far as, you know,
our funding goes for this. We fund it through the Social Security Act. So if people want to know why Social Security isn't, you know, solvent, it isn't sustainable, it's because we are taking money from it, and they're using that money to put it towards the executive, you know, portion of it. Their judges are tied to how much money they produce in child support orders, is how much money the state can collect in just federal funding. And it's such a mess. It's so hard to talk about. There's so many webs involved in this. But the number one.
Yeah, it seems like a very complex issue. I think I talked to somebody about this briefly when we went out to Albuquerque. He is in one of the videos, and he brought up a similar. We're probably talking about the exact same thing.
Tommy Queen. His name is Tommy Queen.
Oh, so you know him? Yeah.
Because we've been following you guys around the country, these rallies, trying to get your cameras to at least talk to us about family law reform. And I'm glad that you were, you know, able to take my call. But the big issue that comes out of this is that our law enforcement doesn't know how to respond when things in court happen. Like, let's say one parent kidnaps another child. The bureaucracy that person has to go through to get their child back is so convoluted and so monetary-based that if you can't afford to pay your child, they just take it away.
I get personal stories all the time from people who have been rung through either in a divorce type situation like that or with CPS trumping up charges against them. It is really criminal what our government has done. And on every level, it is out of control and unresponsive to the people. And it's difficult to do it on a case-by-case basis. So this might be something that maybe we can get our teeth into if we look at the family law reform movement. Because when people come to us with a specific case, there's always, there's so much background to get into it, it's very difficult to investigate it.
I have my own case, but what I'm trying to say is that the government has set up this arena for this to even take place. It's not based upon the Constitution. It's actually upon admiralty law. Mm-hmm. And when you don't have the average citizen, like you guys were saying earlier, you know, the mechanic doesn't know the tax man. Well, most of the time, the computer technician doesn't know a family law attorney. A soldier doesn't know a family law attorney. And to be perfectly honest, with veteran suicide the way it is, even in the VA's top list for problems for veterans, I think it's like 8 or 9 out of the top 10 issues for veteran are family court related. And a lot of it revolves around custody of children. It's kind of one of those unspoken, they know what the problem is, but they can't really fix it. And so that's why we push forward with this Title IV-D reform and that family law reform, basically saying, do you support the right of children to have two fit and loving parents and have those rights protected equally under law? Well, if you do, then you're currently against our family court system. I personally testified in front of our Senate Law and Justice Committee and our House Judiciary Committee here in Washington State. And right next to me was the Family Law Section of the State Bar Association. I just got done testifying my case in front of them. And he comes up and he says, people do commit fraud. People do lie. People lie all the time in family law.
All right, CJ, I'm sorry to cut you off here, but we got to move on to our other callers. If you have some more information, you can send it to us at showtips@infowars.com.
And that's a key thing for people to look up. Look up family law reform. Look up Title IV, because I know there are a lot of people. Divorce is so rampant in our society. Almost everybody is going to get caught up in this at one point or the other. So it's something that we should all be concerned about. And on so many different levels, the judicial system as well as the government is just completely broken. And as he pointed out, it's not even remotely based on the Constitution anymore. It's just based on fraud, complexity, and bluff. Let's just put it that way. Let's go to our next caller.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, CJ. We have a lot of callers from Washington tonight. We have Carl in Washington. Go ahead, Carl.
Hey, how's it going, guys?
Good.
We're good.
Just wanted to say a long-time listener, first-time caller. Everything going on with the social justice warriors down in California. And, with Bernie taking the back seat, you know, I haven't met one legitimate, not in the media, Hillary supporter. I don't know one, you know, my age, my income bracket Hillary supporter. Mm-hmm. I haven't met one. And, you know, Now that that's their only choice, how are we going to get those guys over to Trump?
Well, the issue I see when I go out in the streets and I meet these Hillary supporters that I was talking with Lynn just a second ago, a lot of people I meet that are voting for Hillary are voting for Hillary because she's a woman. And that's not to be sexist or anything like that. It's just what it is. I ask them flat out. I've done several videos about this. What is your favorite Hillary Clinton policy? And they'll either say that she's, you know, was married to Bill Clinton in so many words, or that she's a woman.
That's right.
That's pretty much it.
Yeah, well, I'd say her favorite policy is attacking the people that Bill Clinton has gone after and sexually assaulted.
Yeah, absolutely. I think what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to focus on her criminality. We're also going to have to tell them that we've got some common ground if they want to get this economy back. Look, there's a lot of people on the economic issues, not necessarily not on socialism, but on the economic issues that Bernie opposes the Trans-Pacific and Transatlantic trade agreements because he knows they're going to take jobs. And we see a lot of people within the Democrat Party, like Alan Grayson in Florida, you know, who we wouldn't agree with on a lot of issues. But he understands and he's talked about what has happened with NAFTA, just looking simply at the trade deficit with Mexico as soon as they put in NAFTA. So there's a lot of people on the left that understand that. And so there is some commonality, some common ground there. And if we can appeal to them on that, on the fact that Donald Trump is an outsider who is opposed by all these people who have rigged this process, who have enriched themselves, then I think we do have some common ground. They're going to be very susceptible to all these counterclaims about racism and sexism. That's why this is all coming up. That's to keep the people, the Bernie people, on board with Hillary Clinton. It isn't going to fool anybody in the Republican Party.
They refuse to even bring up La Raza. It's just like out of nowhere. It's just like they just drop. He's a racist. He's a racist. He said this guy needs to go because his ethnicity says he can't do the job. Well, if you look at it, you know, he's a lawyer.
I think we
I think we just lost you momentarily. Let's go to another caller. Marcos, did you say that we have a reporter that wants to join us live? Or who?
Kit Daniels is on the line. Okay. Back in the seat.
Okay, Kit, you wanted to chime in. Go ahead.
I wanted to respond to the caller you just had. If you want to meet a Hillary Clinton supporter, all you got to do is go to a local cemetery. I think you've actually reported on this, David. Is that, like, I think it was in North Carolina where you had all these 112-year-old voters all of a sudden on these registration forms.
That's right. They leave them on the rolls. They're 112 years old. Yeah. And I told you, I had a second-degree connection, I guess. It was my brother-in-law's friend who went to vote, and they said, you've already voted, and your mother has voted. And he goes, well, my mother is dead. And you don't have to produce a voter ID, and the Democrats don't want a voter ID. I mean, to show your driver's license or something else, that's not sufficient. I mean, you're going to have that if you cash a check somewhere. I mean, everybody requires ID.
It's funny. I saw on a newspaper obituary recently where this lady passed away, and she said that, you know, she was glad. The one thing she was glad about is she wouldn't have to vote for crooked politicians ever again. I was like, yeah, right, lady. Next year, you're going to be voting for Hillary Clinton.
Yeah. Very sad. Even in death, you can't get away from this cycle.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so you can't escape death, taxes, or voting Democrat. It's going to continue going on.
Well, thanks so much, Kit. Yeah. We're going to continue with the calls going up to 10 o'clock, and we'll take a break. Let's go ahead and talk to, is it going to be Luther in North Carolina?
I was just want to say I'm a big fan of you guys. I've been listening for a real long time and everything. And, you know, I really like the fight for liberty that we've been having, you know, and I know that we've been having a struggle for years and years and years, you know, with the libertarians trying to get them out there and trying to get everybody, you know, involved in the liberty movement. But the way I see it, man, it just seems like everybody, both the left and the right, it seems like they're both wanting to take away our civil liberties. And it scares the crap out of me. It truly does. It scares me because you have both Clinton and Trump wanting to extend the NSA program. You got them wanting to extend these warrantless wiretaps.
I agree. I don't see anybody, including the libertarian candidates, who really are going to stand up for our personal liberties. I mean, look at what Gary Johnson did with the Nazi cakes issue, where the one of the guys who is also running for the nomination, Austin Peterson, said, would you force the Jewish bakers to bake a cake for Nazis? Because the analogy was Christians. And I guess they took it to the Nazi level because, it's okay to discriminate against Christians. But to everybody's surprise and people booed him in the office, Gary Johnson said, yes, I would do that. I would use government to coerce them into doing something, which is clearly a function of the free market and of private agreements for people. Mm-hmm. And so it really there isn't a choice at the presidential level. And I said this from the beginning. I said this election is about one thing and one thing only, really. It's about globalism versus nationalism. And if we're going to fight for individual liberty, we need to understand that in order to be able to get individual liberty, we need to fight consolidation of government. We have seen our liberties diminish as government's power has gone from the individual to the local government, from the local government to the state government, from the state government to the national government. And now it's about to go from the national government to the global government. And it is going to be almost impossible to get it back at that point. It's going to be really difficult to get it back from the national government. But we have things that we can do if we understand what those things are. Jury nullification, other forms of nullification at the state level. We can still fight for our liberties at the state level. But if we lose our national government, we are going to lose our individual liberties. That's why I said, even though Trump has made some very authoritarian statements, and I don't think he understands a lot of the principles of individual liberty, he does understand nationalism versus globalism. And we need, as libertarians who really want not Libertarian Party people, but people who want individual liberty, we need to understand we got to fight that next level of consolidation if we're going to have a chance to get our liberty back and fight for it at a local level. Not all the problems are going to be solved by having the right person in as the presidency. So just expect that's off the list. There's no difference between any of these candidates. They're all going to take away your individual liberties.
All right. Thank you so much, Luther. I hate to cut you short, but we got to get in one more call before we go to break here. Let's talk to Kaysen in Baltimore.
Hello.
Hey.
Hey, thank you so much for having me. Hold on, let me switch you off speaker.
Yeah, that'd be good. Okay, got it? Casey, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, go ahead.
Sir. Can you hear me again?
Yes.
Yeah, we're running short on time. Go ahead.
I had one point to make about this latest problem with Trump with the judge. And I think his main way out of it is to focus like a laser on his connection with La Raza.
Yes.
You guys yourselves have plenty of footage from violent protesters of Trump supporters when they're leaving the rallies on the West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
It hardly ever gets mentioned on network TV. I'm thinking maybe he could at least pull a few strings at Fox and get Fox to hammer it home. I think I've heard it mentioned once, and I watch nothing but news.
Yes, I agree. That's the big mistake I think he made. And I've talked about it on Sunday. I talked about it yesterday. I read quotes from Cesar Chavez. This is a guy who said La Raza is racist. It is anti-gringo. It is discrimination. And you're going to go from anti-gringo to anti-negro. And it needs to be shut down. And when he said that, his friends said the expressions fell because his Latino followers thought that he was about nationalism. And it turned out he was for humanity. And we need to understand, as you're talking about with these Mexican flags and everything else, he needs to say it's La Raza, and La Raza is about a competing form of nationalism, and you can see it in the riots. That's the direction that he needs to go. He needs to quote Chavez, who is a Hispanic organizer. Yeah.
Exactly. They want Texas back. They want California back.
Yes.
They want everything that we gained in a war that was hundreds of years ago back, and he is the lawyer faction of that movement, and there is so much that can be proven about this guy.
I agree.
That has not been said. It hasn't been mentioned at all.
Absolutely. We're out of time. Thank you so much for calling. Hang on. We got a couple more callers there. We're going to get back to you. We got to take a quick break at the top of the hour. We're going to be right back with some more results out of California, your calls, and our reporters on location. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Very close.
Yeah. Yeah. Welcome back to InfoWars Nightly News, live coverage of the final presidential primaries. This is hour number four, and we're going to have some reports from Joe Biggs as well as our other reporters in the field. I want to get you caught up to all the results, except for California has not called in. They have just closed their polls just a couple of minutes ago. So we don't have any reports from California, but I can give you the results from the other five states. Then we're going to go to our callers here. We've got the smaller states that have called in, that have had the election. So far, it's not set in Montana. It's very close in Montana. Hillary is ahead 48.6 to Bernie at 46.7. 48.6 to 46.7. Pretty close in Montana, but there's not a lot of delegates there. Also, in New Mexico, Hillary has won there, it looks like. Hillary, 53, Bernie, 47. South Dakota, again, Hillary, 51, Bernie, 49. That's with 80% of the vote. They've not called that one yet either. That's also pretty close. The only place where Bernie has won is North Dakota. He won that handily, 64 to 26. In New Jersey, again, Hillary won 63 to 37. A big margin there. So the question mark remains California. And the results tonight with the five states that have voted so far, Hillary has is ahead narrowly in two of those states and has won two others. So with only one state going for Bernie and a small state at that, it did not help him with the number of delegates that right. he would get out of the election. And that, I think, was a key thing for him to have to have. They really undercut that, as we've been saying all night, with the announcement early today. From the AP saying, hey, we've done the math, and Hillary has exactly the number of delegates.
How does that happen?
Superdelegates. Yeah,
how does that happen?
I smell a rat. We all smell a rat with that. I mean, that is exactly what we would expect the mainstream media to do for Hillary Clinton. They've been in her court all along. They're not going to be there as impartial judges of that. And so that was very suspicious, and it discouraged a lot of people who would vote in these primaries, especially in California. They're going to have time to digest that information more time than everybody else. And that's kind of like calling the winner before you have the election. They're very careful about not releasing the results of these individual states until all the polls have closed. And yet they did that this morning before these final six primaries. I think essentially shutting down the chances that Bernie had to win the number of delegates and say to the superdelegates, you're reversing the will of the people. You need to switch and come with me and follow the will of the people. But at this point, with these election results, and of course, I'm sure there was some rigging on the elections, especially the close ones.
We know they do that, right? Come on.
So, but with these official results that they've got here, now she's going to be able to go in and say, but I won the plurality, and the superdelegates are just making this a majority, a 50% plus one vote. That's where we are.
Though, wow, I can't believe that. It's like getting a hole in one. How do you get the exact number? But each his own.
She didn't even have to roll it into the cup. I mean, she just fly ball and it just goes straight.
Dropped in like a ice cube or something.
Yeah.
Okay.
So convenient.
All right. Like David said, we're to our last hour and we're also down to our final four callers. I know there are more people that wanted to call in, but we have to go back to our reporters and more special reports. So these are the final four. Let's go to Mike in California. Go ahead, Mike.
How you doing today?
Good.
Doing good.
Hey, I'm from Redding, California, and I just wanted to say that last Friday that we had a rally there, and we only had one protester, and we had about 3,000 in the gate, and then the fire marshal shut the gate, and there's a few thousand out.
Mm-hmm.
But my point was is that when Trump actually spoke, he was talking to the media to show all the people, and they wouldn't show him. They actually put their thumbs down. So I thought that was pretty interesting that, you know, it looks like
Put their thumbs down? I'm not sure.
Yeah. Explain that to us. We're both kind of puzzled.
They had their, if you put your thumb up like, that's a good job, they put their thumbs down when he asked them to show all the people that
were. So you're saying they're basically communicating no?
Yes, okay. Basically.
Oh, so he asked the media to show the crowd, and the media just says, put thumbs down, and said, no, we're not going to do that?
Pretty much, exactly.
Wow, yeah. Yeah, they're pretty biased, aren't they?
Yes, and the thing is, I was up front, and I was helping out with the VIP pit, and it was like 104. It was like hot.
Mm-hmm.
And they brought out water and everything, and I was fortunate enough to meet Trump out on the tarmac before he left. And he just seems like a regular Joe. I mean, really nice guy. I told him that I built like three websites, one for Northern California, one for Southern, and one for Central. because I work for the railroad, and I'm able to travel in different areas. Actually, I'm from Redding, but I'm by Fresno, California right now. And the interesting thing about Fresno was there was about one-third Hispanic people there inside the convention. It was so interesting because they had us go around, but I met so many Hispanic people because I'm trying to populate the websites with pictures, and they're just saying a lot of the people that are out there are just so uneducated, and then they go with what their friends say. They don't even read policy. They don't really understand what's really going on here. They just think he's racist, and they don't, you know, they're not educated.
That's right. And you know, and they don't have anything to say when we engage them and say, why is he racist? Okay. He triggered the social justice warriors on political correctness. And so that makes him a dyed-in-the-wool racist to the media, to the college kids that come out and protest. But when we're talking about Hispanics, there are a lot of Hispanics who support Donald Trump.
Absolutely.
You've interviewed them.
And, absolutely.
Yeah.
That's when we go out to these rallies, you know, of course, they don't want to show these people on other news stations, but we go out to these rallies like the one in Albuquerque. And like you said, they'll show, you know, the anti-Trump people, but we showed the thousands upon thousands of people that entered this building to see Donald Trump. Many of them were Hispanics.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
And the small, it's really interesting because, you know, it's just a small minority and it's people that are getting paid. And it's like, I just find it very interesting that, you know, they can burn these American flags, but if they really want to be here, I think they should leave. I mean, you don't see Americans burning, you know, Mexican flags. I mean,
that's right.
It just really bothers me. You know, actually, I look Hispanic is what's really interesting. I look Hispanic, but I'm three quarters German, a quarter American Indian. So working with the railroad, I work all over the country with a lot of different people. I actually build bridges and I get to hear what people say. And when they talk about it, they just hear bullet points or what the media says. They don't really get to hear, like, you know, the Hispanic judge was part of La Raza. They just hear what, you know, CNN says, the little sound bite, and then they take it and run.
Well, it's just a talking point, because just like you said there, they hear the sound bite. It's almost like they're reading it off a cue card. It's just so formulated, and it's so copied by everybody else who's out there. You can tell they get read it off the same website or we're watching the same broadcast. Thank you so much, Mike. We have to move on to our other callers. Let's go on now to Ben in California. Go ahead, Ben. Oh, on Ontario.
Go ahead. Yeah. Go ahead, Ben.
Oh, hey. Good evening, guys.
Hey, how you doing?
Very good, very good. Happy to talk to you all. Great job from everybody from top to bottom. Really great job.
Well, thank you, and thank you for calling.
My question was sort of a situation and the result of that. Let's say it's early October. The election is going full force, and all of a sudden the FBI arrests Hillary. Now, does Bernie get on the ticket, or does Bill, can he go back on the ticket? What would happen then for the election?
I don't know about Bill.
I really don't know, but, you know, I don't think that's a scenario that's going to happen. She can be, and I believe she is, clearly guilty of sin. And they have come after people like Thomas Drake, who is an NSA whistleblower. I've interviewed him. They came after him for nothing and tried to put him in jail. They're not going to come after Hillary. I think if they do come after Hillary, you're going to see Obama pardon her, or you're going to see something like that. But they are not. They may indict Hillary Clinton, but I don't think that they're going to convict Hillary Clinton. She's too big to jail, quite frankly, and that's the way our government works, and we understand what the corruption is. She's going to have to be defeated before we ever have a chance of convicting and jailing her. And that's why this is going to be a big race. Because they're both in it. You know, their backs are to the wall. Donald Trump has to defeat her, or she is going to come after Donald Trump and destroy his life. Mm-hmm. And if she doesn't, if Donald Trump wins,
she's going to
put
jail.
Her in jail. Yeah, it's going to be the White House or the Big House for Hillary. So this is a key election for them. Their back is to the wall, and he's not wasting any time. He's not sitting back and making some kind of a political calculation. Well, should I wait and release this information closer to the election so it has a bigger impact? No, he's going to have a press conference
Monday,
beginning of next week, and he's going to lay it all out there for the American people. All right, Hillary is the nominee. Let me tell you about who she is. And he's going to start defining her for a lot of these social justice warriors who don't know anything about it because they were in diapers the first time the Clintons were committing their crimes.
And also, when you talk about the timing, let's say the feds do come after her. I think if they really want to make a statement, this is a new, clean FBI that's going to go after true criminals, they come after her now. She just had this big nomination. She's out there shaking hands and kissing babies. They set her up and knock her down. If they were going to do it, I think now would be the time.
Yeah, and look at how many times they have been involved in just every kind of influence peddling and corruption and criminal activity and gotten away with it. I mean, literally getting away with rape and with murder and with allowing the standing by and being complicit in the murder of the people in Benghazi, for example. I mean, it's just, it goes on and on and on. The rap sheet for the Clintons is so long that he can start right now trying to define it. He still won't be finished by the time we have the election in November. You know that?
That is true.
I think that after the press conference, there's going to be an earthquake across America from all the triggering. Everybody that's going to get triggered is going to cause an earthquake. Well, thank you very much, guys. I don't want to take too much time. I want to let everybody else talk.
Well, thank you for calling.
Have a great evening, and it was great talking to you. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Ben in California. Now we're going to go to Ben in Wisconsin. Go ahead, Ben.
Hello, gentlemen.
Hey, how you doing?
Good evening, Mr. Jackson.
How you doing?
Thank you for taking my call. I know it's late. Mr. Knight, thank you for being a modern-day Edward R. Murrow.
Well, thank you. That's a nice compliment.
How ironic that Bilderberg is 48 hours away and Hillary is getting the nomination tonight, seeing as she broke the Logan Act last summer by attending Bilderberg. Mm-hmm. I just want to bring up, I don't know if this is off track, but the Premier Election Solutions, formerly known as Diebold, the electronic voting hardware.
Right.
If that's going to be how we vote this time around, who's to say that's, I mean, even going back to 2000 with Bush in Florida or Ohio, do you think that could be an issue coming up?
Yes. Just as we were saying before, you know, you look at these states where it's close. We know that you have to win by a huge landslide before they will change things, before they won't change the results. And I think when you look at electronic voting, that even that rule of thumb can go out the door, because you're talking about Diebold, but we've also got Smartmatic, which is the largest electronic voting machine company. They were paid $80,000 by the GOP in Utah to run their primary. And these are people who have a list of countries throughout Central and South America and the Philippines where they've been accused of rigging elections. I think it was in the Philippines or either in Mexico's Tabasco region, one of those two places where they've been accused of rigging the elections. They lost 24% of the vote, just disappeared, and there were no tracking records for those votes. I mean, millions of votes just disappeared because of electronic voting. So there's a potential for incredibly massive fraud. You're absolutely right. And we have to be very concerned about this. And that's a real key part of this election. It's going to have to be a gigantic landslide, unquestionable landslide, in order for Donald Trump to win, or they're going to rig it. And if it is a landslide, they may go ahead and let him get in and figure they'll handle him in a different way. But that's I think, is going to be a big factor.
And when you talk about voter fraud, there's this growing voice out there for people calling for this thing called the blockchain, which is basically a digital ledger. So, like, if you hear, like, your grandma, whoever we were just talking about, been dead for 10 years, and they say she voted, you can go and check and actually see if your grandma voted or if they switched your vote around. And I think that's something, if we're going to keep the digital machines, that we should definitely look into.
Oh, absolutely. There's so many different ways they can rig the system. They can rig it with not having proper voter ID. They can rig it with the way they count and tabulate the votes, or when the custody of the votes that can be rigged at that point, when they report the votes from local areas. So that's every juncture of this thing can be rigged in one way or the other. And they fight any kind of accountability, anything that would make the system more secure, more honest. They fight it tooth and nail. That should tell you something. When they don't want to have photo ID, Jakari, it is not because they're trying to make it hard for black people to vote or punish any minority. They simply want to have their entry points for fraud. Absolutely. That's all there is to it.
All right, thank you so much, Ben. We have Joe Biggs now, I believe, standing by. He's ready to talk out there at a Bernie rally. Joe Biggs, are you ready? Who's that you're talking to there?
Okay. Say that again?
Joe Biggs, Joe. Go ahead.
Oh, okay.
You're live.
Sorry. What's your name, sir? We're live right now.
My name is Alfred Pirovitz, and I'm here mostly to promote an environmental project that I have in Brentwood. I've taken control of about 1,300 square feet on the property belonging to the veterans, which is sublet to the post office, Carl Malden United States Postal Service Station on Barrington Avenue near Sunset. It's a regenerative project to which I have added roughly 7 tons wet weight of coffee grounds, Starbucks, if you will.
So what are you out here for today? Like Bernie Sanders?
I like Bernie Sanders. I'm an environmentalist.
Well, what was some of the stuff you were doing earlier?
Okay, rock and roll, and I do a lot of different stuff.
Well, let's hear it.
All right, it looks like okay. Okay.
Interesting.
All right,
there's a Bernie Sanders supporter. He's feeling the burn as we're speaking right now. And I guess the only question would be, where is he feeling that burn?
All right. Thank you so much, Biggs.
That was important. Thank you, Joe.
So what we have right now, as you can see, there's more and more people starting to show up. They're actually.
You know what? I got to say, you got like doctors, lawyers, PhDs, and you picked the guy who's singing in the parking lot.
Well, we've actually talked to many of
why aren't you talking to people who actually.
Let's talk to her.
We've actually been talking to people. You just showed up at the wrong time. But thank you for your opinion.
Well, thank you for not doing your job.
I am doing my job.
Hey,
I voted for Trump.
Ask her if she's got some of those special PhD credentials. She can talk to us.
Interviewing anyone?
Hey, so why are you here today?
I'm here because I'm in support of Bernie Sanders for president of the United States.
So one of the issues he's running on is he wants to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour. How's that going to work out?
Well, how's it going to work out? I'm not sure I understand.
How's it going to work out? Because, you know, a lot of these different companies, they have now brought in robots to run stuff. You have different fast food networks.
That's definitely true. That's definitely true. And the economy's changing, and it makes it very difficult for a lot of people who work a full-time amount of time during the week, like 40 hours plus in a week. It makes it very hard for them to support themselves when incomes have been dropping over the last few years. It's very difficult to support a family on less than $15 an hour, even at 40 hours a week. So Bernie's message of being of believing that you should be able to support to survive on your own by working 40 hours a week. Resonates with me.
But like an entry-level job, like at a fast food place, that is meant to motivate you to do something better on down the road. That shouldn't be a job that you settle at and you're using. I know some people have to have that job, but we should be promoting people to go into higher education. We should have people in welding jobs, things like that.
I agree.
Not saying you should stay, but that's what that promotes when you do the $15 an hour.
I totally agree with you that I think everyone who's in those jobs would agree with you that not everyone wants to work at McDonald's forever. That's a transitional job for them too. The problem is when they don't have the same economic opportunities, educational opportunities, when they're disenfranchised by the political system and they feel like they don't have someone who represents them, they don't have a good opportunity to move up
hey, Joe,
using the kind of systems that by talking about.
Yes.
Like let's ask him on the trade issues. I want to ask him on the trade issues. Bernie doesn't support the TPP and the TTIP.
But I'm happy to stay for another show.
He wants to know about the TPP. What are your thoughts on that?
I think that the TPP represents a project that doesn't provide a sufficient amount of benefit in American jobs to outweigh the potential environmental disaster that could come with it. And so I think that it has value that I do understand why the right believes in it, but I think that the potential consequences of it far outweigh what the benefits are. So that's why I'm and like Bernie.
Do you think that a war has created climate change?
I think I think if you're in war, it's probably rough weather, if that's what you mean. But I don't think war necessarily creates. I'm not sure I understand your question.
But I've heard a lot of people, Bernie Sanders supporters, that say that these wars have created climate change and has helped escalate that.
I don't think that the act of fighting in a war is something that would necessarily contribute to climate change, but the military-industrial complex that leads to the consumption of fossil fuels and the wars that are predicated on the need for fossil fuels, that ultimately does contribute to climate change. And so in that sense, I wouldn't call it a one-to-one direct correlation, but I think there is a connection there. I think, Joe, it's fair to say. I wouldn't say that's the main environmental
Joe, ask him. Tell him that we agree with him on the trade issues and ask him if he doesn't think that maybe the jobs that have been lost for NAFTA would be exactly the kind of jobs that would help people to move up from these minimum wage jobs.
I think you guys are doing a great job, by the way. I'm not here to argue. I do have to get out here just to get in line a second, but I'm happy to answer another question if you'd like.
Ask him if he doesn't agree that NAFTA has taken away the kind of jobs that we want people to have so that we don't have to mandate a minimum wage.
Do you agree that NAFTA has taken away the kind of jobs that we would want to have?
I think that NAFTA offers the opportunity for companies in America to sell their goods abroad in a way that they couldn't do without NAFTA. But the trade-off is that those companies don't have the same kind of worker protections that we do. So they end up getting away with being able to, pennies on the dollar, have a workforce that's very inexpensive, like you see in China and the Philippines and Taiwan and Mexico. And so as a result, the NAFTA has been a disaster for American workers. Because they can't compete with countries who are essentially cheating. So NAFTA in that sense is terrible for the American worker, but excellent for American big business. So it's not inherently good or bad.
Pay everybody more for the bad ones.
And Bernie represents the workers. And as a result, Bernie is not pro NAFTA. He's not pro trade agreement. So I think I am also pro worker. I am a worker. So
what about Bernie not really ever working until he's about 40 years old?
Bernie, I would argue that Bernie being in politics is a job and that he has been trying to represent working people through that job for a very long time. And that resonates with me. I think that that's a sign of good leadership.
I mean, I can't represent professional football players. I've never been one.
That's true. I represent them how? I mean, what represent?
I mean, how could he represent workers if he never really worked?
I think that when we say workers, it's more about, why does someone work? They work because they want to support their... Oh, I got to get in line over there. I'm so sorry, guys. I have to get into the rally. I love InfoWars. Cool. I'm a supporter of Alex Jones. You guys rock. I hope you have a great set of interviews tonight. I represent Bernie. I understand everyone has different opinions.
And that's why we're here, yeah.
Yeah, and so please keep up the good work, and please portray this.
Hey, guess what? Feel safe tonight, because you know what? Trump supporters aren't going to throw eggs at you.
I hope not, and I hope that you portray this fairly, and I hope that you guys have a safe time as well.
Oh, yeah. Awesome, man.
Thank you very much.
Have a good one.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Joe. The guy had at least arguments for his points of view, and he was a very well-spoken guy.
We figured bring a little comedy into it as well, though, with that one guy. The guy's been running around acting crazy. But, lot of the people we've spoken to tonight have been very knowledgeable in a lot of the things. I can agree with a lot of the things they have to say. So we're not too far, far gone from each other's standpoints. The only thing I can't really get past is the entire socialist or democratic socialism thing and all that. And I don't really understand how the $15 an hour is really going to pan out. It's really going to, we're going to lose jobs. And a lot of these corporations or these businesses are going to have to, go to these automated systems like we're seeing already.
That's right. We need to get, it's just going to increase the pressure for people to replace workers with robots. You're exactly right. And the only way that they're going to get better paying jobs is if we stop exporting our jobs and importing workers, which means we're going to have to get control of the borders. It's not a racist thing. It is simply an economic thing. It's a national thing. And there is a nationalist aspect to these La Raza Dreamer riots where they protest Trump. But I think on a lot of issues there, I think we can reach some common ground with some of the Bernie supporters. Whether or not they will wind up supporting Trump, it's still a stretch for them. I don't know where they're going to go at this point.
At the end of the day, you can't put 10 people in a two-man canoe, It's going to sink.
That's right. That's right.
Very good analogy.
That's right.
I do here.
We got some results here from California, and this is kind of interesting, Joe. They closed the polls about 26 minutes ago. They've only got 3% reporting in so far. So I don't know if this is going to change a great deal. It's been holding kind of constant. Hillary is way ahead of Bernie in California, and it may be because they told everybody, hey, this is all over. Don't bother to show up. But right now, she's about 2-1 over him. It's 62% for Hillary, 37% for Bernie. So this is crazy. Not what people thought was going to happen, and that crowd there is not going to be very happy if that's a Bernie crowd.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what Bernie says when he comes out here. It looks like it was supposed to start at 8 o'clock. Now it's not going to start till 10 p.m. tonight. So that information will definitely trickle down to those guys, and I'm sure when they make that announcement inside this hangar, we'll hear people from the outside here kind of yelling and upset about that. But, this is the whole thing, though. We saw that with Rand Paul. Rand Paul didn't really put up a fight. He dropped out too early. He didn't put up a fight. And that's one of the things I wish he would have done. And one of the things Bernie Sanders hasn't really been doing that well is putting up a fight against Hillary Clinton. We need that from him more, because the last thing we need is another Clinton in the White House. And she's going to come in here. She is the worst person for the job. I mean, she is the most elite of elite people. Yeah. And she has nothing but the best interests of her pockets
in mind at all.
You know, Joe, in the debate when he said, he says, I am tired of hearing about your damn emails. He was done at that point. He was absolutely done. He could have taken the high ground, but he basically threw that issue, that corruption issue, that character issue, which is a key thing for people that support him. He basically threw that away for a lot of other people when he pulled that out. And so I think that really hurt him at that point. But it's going to be very difficult for him to move forward now, because tonight we're looking at him losing everywhere except for North Dakota. There he won big. He won 64-26. Everywhere else, Hillary is either slightly ahead or way ahead. And the coup de grace is California, where right now with 7% reporting, it is still holding constant at 63-37.
And then also the superdelegates don't even get their vote until July 26, I believe, if I'm correct.
Well, a lot of the superdelegates have declared, and that's why we see that they've got on the delegate results, they show superdelegates 571 for Hillary, 48 for Bernie. As a matter of fact, they totaled up her superdelegates even before they started doing any voting. She was already there with 15% of the votes that she needed to get the nomination before the first vote was cast by the public. So yep. They're still showing that. But I'm talking about the pledged delegates. I think his only chance of really kind of making a case to stay in this was for him to say, hey, I've got a plurality of the people who voted in the elections, and the superdelegates are going against the will of the people who voted in the elections. And so he could have made the case to the superdelegates, follow what the public has done. But he's losing in the votes of I'm sure they're rigging this election, as we joked about earlier, but according to the official results, he's behind in that. So it's going to be hard for him to make the case that the superdelegates should reverse the will of the people. Now he's in exactly the opposite position.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, and one of the things that's appealing about Donald Trump that people like is the fact that he's a fighter. He gets up there, he speaks his mind. You know, when someone says something, he comes out there and hits them back hard. And people in America kind of feel like Obama's just laid down and rolled over. And I think that's one of the appealing things, is that he is out there fighting. And one of the things you're not seeing from Bernie as much is that fighting mentality to get out there and really call Hillary Clinton out on a lot of these important issues, the things that she's been involved in. That would help him out a lot. That would have helped him out a lot. And I think that's one of the reasons you have a poor turnout so far.
I agree. Well, thank you so much, Joe. And I know that rally is going to be starting at some point. I guess Bernie's trying to decide how he's going to spend this, because it's not looking good for him in California. We've got Leanne McAdoo waiting to come online. Thank you so much, Joe Biggs, California. We're going to go to Leanne McAdoo, also in California. Leanne.
Hi, David. Well, we were out here at one of the wrap parties for the Hillary Clinton for president. We actually spoke to two women. They were the lesbian couple who were able to get marriage equality. They were the first to sue, I guess. They were the ones named there on that bill many years ago. And so they were very outspoken, admittedly Democratic socialists voting for Clinton and not for Bernie Sanders. And so we've actually uploaded a video there. It talks about Democratic socialism and why they're voting for Hillary Clinton. And David, we've looked into this before, you and I. If you go to the Socialists of America Party or the Democratic Socialists of America, it says there on their website how they support the people who are going to get the most progressive agenda passed. Mm-hmm. And of course, once they get it passed, that's the only reason why they've attached themselves to the Democratic Party, is because they need those people who are going to get it pushed as far to the left as possible. And so Bernie Sanders, he didn't really come into this wanting to become the president. He never thought he was going to become the president, but that was his agenda, was to force Hillary Clinton to move even further to the left, which is exactly what has happened. And now when you have two very prominent activists in the gay community saying that they're backing Hillary Clinton for that very reason. This video, when you see the passion in this woman's face of what she's talking about, that in the next 4 years, this democratic socialism is going to be running this country, you watch, and that Hillary Clinton was the candidate who could get this passed. And I mean, it was frightening. And so that's why because I asked her, you know, how do you explain to all the young Bernie supporters out there who aren't going to want to go to Hillary? They say they will even go vote for Trump rather than Hillary president. How do you get them on your side? And that's where she was going, was that this is the plan. It's 4 years of this, and then you're going to get everything Bernie's promising you, and those, because they're going to push it as far to the left as possible. I mean, it's frightening.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, she's not only a tool of Wall Street, and as Donald Trump said, she and Billary.
That's accurate.
I've been calling
that's
that accurate. For a long time, the Billary presidency. They were essentially running a corrupt hedge fund. You know, their political careers have been that with graft and corruption. It doesn't surprise me that Hillary would get the lesbian vote. That's kind of a given. But she has talked for a long time about being a progressive, and she does have a very radical progressive agenda that's there. But she's also a crony capitalist with deep ties to Wall Street. And she's tried to pull away from both of those things. And I think that Bernie staying in and going to the contested convention is going to bring that to the forefront. And it's going to make it harder for her in the general election. I think she would like to downplay that. I think she would like to keep that agenda hidden. But I think he is going to force that agenda out in the open. Let's say he's going to out her as a progressive socialist.
Yeah, well, it seems as if he should have been doing that this entire time, but mm-hmm. he didn't want to alienate himself from the party, from everyone, or knowing that he wasn't going to win eventually. He might potentially be her VP at some point. He didn't want to call her out and put all of her dirty deeds out there. So we'll see how far he takes it, but I mean, it'll be interesting to see what he says tonight at his rally.
Well, you know, she is a crony capitalist, and so on a lot of these issues, she is really about economic fascism when it comes to giving favors to the corporations that favor her. But on other issues, like gun control, she is far more radical than even Bernie Sanders. Bernie Sanders did not want to come after gun companies if they hadn't done anything that would be a criminal liability. Mm-hmm. But she wants to, she has hectored him throughout this entire campaign, saying, look at this. He doesn't want to shut down gun manufacturers.
Yeah, he's not anti-gun enough.
Yeah, exactly. And he kept saying, well, wait a minute. If they haven't harmed anybody, there is no liability any more than Ford has a liability if somebody is a drunk driver and murders someone because of the way they operated the car. So, you know, he's said that from the very beginning. And, of course, there is a congressional law in addition to the Constitution, the Second Amendment, and due process and other things saying that you should not be penalized if you haven't done anything wrong. But that's not good enough for Hillary. She will do anything to take away the gun. So she's far more radical than Bernie is on many of these issues. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a very dangerous thing. And, of course, Donald Trump is going to point that out.
Yeah. Well, and I also think it's incredibly dangerous if you're seeing what we're seeing in California with so many people who are just so excited about Hillary Clinton and the fact that knowing that she's the one that's going to get through to push that really progressive agenda and that in 4 years, if she's out, or 8 years, whoever's next, all of these young people here are totally primed to bring in the next Bernie Sanders or someone else. So the Democratic Socialists have been on this long con job, mm-hmm. have really kind of sunk mm-hmm. their talons in and have been working on this for a very long time. And we're starting to see the results of that now. It's pretty frightening.
Well, I remember when she was first lady. And she tried to nationalize health care. And she didn't want to go to any half measures or gradualism. I mean, it was a full out, we're going straight to single payer, government controlled health care for everybody. Didn't even try to make the pretense of Obamacare, which we all know is a gradual process to that end result. But she went for the whole thing at the very beginning. And that was 25 years ago that she was doing that. She is a hardcore radical progressive. And she is going to do everything she can against her enemies. And that's what I said. This is not only for Donald Trump, but for America. It is a do or die election. She is going to destroy this country. She's going to finish what Obama did. She's going to be far more radical in her agenda than even Obama was. And she's going to push this much faster. I think that if she picks Elizabeth Warren, we need to have the Thelma and Louise icon with the two of them driving car America over the cliff with a pedal to the metal and all the dollar bills flying out of the convertible, because that's what it's going to be.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it's really surprising here to see so many people that can just overlook all of her scandals. And we're here. It's just like the Bernie bots or the Clinton computers. They're all just like, she's going to unite the country. Everything's going to be great. There's going to be no racism because it's just all about the collective now. No yes. more for the individual, no free thinkers.
That's right.
Everyone's got their talking points, and it'll be really interesting to see what this country looks like in a few years if we can't turn it around.
She's going to unite the country into one collective Borg, and we will all be assimilated. Thank you so much, Leanne McAdoo from California. And we have a special report from Tim Kennedy that we wanted to run for you that we didn't get a chance to air completely today earlier on the radio. Let's go to that report right now.
The politicians of today, they suck. When you look at the founding fathers, the people that cultivated this country, that created us from a revolution, right? We were being controlled, tormented, imprisoned, near slaves to the government, the British government at the time. And these people said, "We're done. We're over it. We're gonna throw some tea off a ship, and then a single shot is gonna ring out, and it's gonna change the course of this beautiful land forever." The people that wrote the Declaration of Independence and then the Constitution, they were people that understood what real work meant. They understood what hard work was. They weren't lifetime politicians that had never had a real job in their entire life. They didn't have a foundation that was worth billions. They weren't, you know, a Secretary of State that were given hundreds of millions of dollars by foreign governments for the things that they did. They were doctors. They were lawyers. They were farmers. They were ranchers. They were engineers. They were inventors. They were people that had hands that bled. They had minds that never stopped working. They went to bed exhausted every day, not in the luxury golden parachute that the politicians live under today. They worked from sunup way past sundown. The sun went down, they couldn't work in their field anymore or in their shop anymore. They're now, you know, working under candlelight, writing the foundation of what is our country. They're swimming across rivers of ice, fighting Indians and the French. They were valiant. They were brave. They didn't dodge the draft. They didn't take their medals and throw them over a fence. They knew what it took to build something. Then they didn't take that credit and say, "Oh, somebody else helped me build it." They built it. They built this, and now it's dematerializing. When you have an idea, and that idea is freedom, and there's aspects of it that you have to exercise, like a muscle. You have to work your muscles out all the time for them to be strong. If you don't, atrophy sets in, and slowly they get weaker. That is what our freedoms are doing right now. If you don't exercise them, they're getting weaker by the day. You have to exercise your freedoms. The founding fathers knew that, and that's what they're doing. They were overthrowing a government. They were starting a revolution. And then knowing what it took to do that and the risk and death and the blood and the screams, they didn't want to risk that again. So then they gave us, the people, the power to try to prevent that from ever happening. And we, the people, are giving that away right now. The founding fathers had wisdom. They had foresight. And that was because they knew what hard work was. And the freedoms are constructs. They're going to blow away unless we start working them. So right now, figure out the best way that you can go exercise your freedom of speech, your freedom to bear arms, your freedom of religion. Do it. The founding fathers wanted you to do it. Go do it.
All right, again, that was a special message from Tim Kennedy, and we are in hour number four. Thank you so much for joining us. We're going to give you a quick wrap-up here of what we see in California, the results so far. It looks like California is not going to change anything for Bernie. I've been watching these numbers as they slowly go up. We are now to 8% reporting, and the percentages really aren't changing. It's 63 to 36%, Hillary Clinton ahead. And the only place that Bernie Sanders won was in North Dakota, where he came out 64-26. So he did really well there, but he's not doing too well anywhere else across the country. There's a couple of close races, but Hillary Clinton is winning all five of the races, including the big one in California, where Bernie Sanders had pinned all of his hopes, Jagari.
Absolutely, and... Well, I'm not a Sanders supporter. I really wish he would have did better, just because I'm not a Hillary supporter. I don't like Bernie, but I don't like Hillary that much more. But
well, he was anti-establishment. He was outside the establishment because he's a socialist, not a Democrat.
Which and at least he didn't have you know, this closet full of skeletons of these scandals. And it really is disturbing to me that people will completely overlook just the laundry list of Clinton stories going
corruption
back decades.
Is not an issue anymore. I mean, you know, he was, like you said, he was an authentic guy. And compared to Hillary, he seems like an honest guy. He doesn't have the scandals. There may be something happening with his wife and that university, but I don't think that's a corruption I don't think that's really corruption. And it may be incompetence. It may be something that she did wrong on her own, but it is not like the Clintons buying and selling influence out of government. Okay, raping people. I mean, this kind of rampant Caligula Rome type of corruption, and people just don't care about it. They just don't care. And so, yeah, nobody's got a perfect life, but Bernie was not a Roman emperor like the Clintons, okay? And it's really sad to see that really doesn't make any difference to them. They're just going to completely ignore that and go with somebody that is known to be such a corrupt entity. And so, yeah, from that standpoint, we disagreed with a lot of the policies of Bernie. We agreed with some of his policies. I mean, he was for some things that we agree with. But that's the thing I think is very concerning, to see how she can sweep this through with the Democrat establishment and the Democrat voters because they just look the other way for the corruption.
Absolutely. Now, we're going to end with this special report since we're talking about Mrs. Clinton, a special report from John Baum. But before we do that, we definitely want to thank everybody who's been watching us tonight. I know it's been a very long broadcast, but it's support of people like you that allow us to do these broadcasts, that put us in the studio, the new studio that Kit was broadcasting out of, to send the reporters around the world, Rob Dew, Leanne McAdoo, John Bound, who's going to show us this report, Richard Reeves, Joe Biggs, everybody out there in the field. It's your support when you go to InfoWars.com, when you go to InfoWars Shop, you get the great products there. You get the great nutraceuticals. You get the T-shirts, the Hillary for Prison T-shirts. Very popular right now. You can get those at a great price. Also, the Anthroplex and the many other things there, the air filters, everything there at the InfoWars Shop. So we're going to sign off tonight with this special report from John Bound talking about Hillary Clinton, the criminal psychopath of the NWO. And this is a report that you definitely want to watch. You want to get this out to your friends and family. It's a very topical report, especially with Mrs. Clinton so close to clinching the nomination. I'm Jakari Jackson from the InfoWars Nightly News, joined by David Knight here in the studio, and we'll see you again tomorrow night.
Prepare yourself for the main event. Hillary Clinton has, by most accounts, clinched the Democratic presidential nomination, dragging her mountainous pile of scandals into the last round to possibly make her the next president of the United States. Hillary's rise to the White House is akin to Richard Nixon in reverse. This is the same woman who recently gave a speech on income inequality wearing a $12,000 Armani jacket. The same woman who, according to a Secret Service account, punched Bill Clinton so hard she gave him a black eye. Granted, Bill probably deserved it, but that is only one clear example of the temperament that could quite possibly have access to 1,750 active nuclear warheads.
She's got health issues, and they're going back and asking me and others that have known her since the beginning, what is it about Hillary? And Hillary, Alex, has had a mental issue since day one. She does not like people. She is an animal. She's everything I've told you she is. And it is a mental problem. And that's what's causing her trouble running this election, to be quite honest. You can't make her a people person. You just can't do it. And so that's where we're at. But there's going to be stories about that. But remember, none of these things are going to hurt Hillary. None.
And the Secret Service desperately wants Americans to know that the real Hillary Clinton is a monster. According to Page Six, Secret Service agent Gary Byrne writes in his new tell-all book that Hillary repeatedly screamed obscenities at her husband, Secret Service personnel, and White House staffers, all of whom lived in terror of her next tirade. Secret Service agents had discussions about the possibility that they would have to protect Bill from his wife's physical attacks, Burns writes. and the couple had one violent encounter the morning of a key presidential address to the nation. Will Hillary spend the first 100 days of her presidency pardoning herself and permanently silencing her husband's accusers, simultaneously sicking the IRS and the FBI on the Clintons' enemies? Here are just a few of the unanswered scandals that will surface yet again when Hillary is president, courtesy of WorldNet Daily. Vince Foster's 1993 death, Benghazi, Whitewater, Emailgate, Chinagate, Travelgate, Pardongate, the Clinton body count, where 91% of the Clinton Foundation's money really went. Hillary's assistant, Muslim Brotherhood tied Huma Abedin's involvement with the Saudis to establish a Muslim America, and we could be here all day if I just kept on going. But it appears stealing the Democratic presidential nomination is child's play to the career criminal known as Hillary Rodham Clinton. The Clintons even attempted to loot the White House when Bill's term ended. The Clintons tried to take $190,000 from the presidential mansion in furniture and gifts, attempting to have it shipped back to the Clintons' Chappaqua, New York home. And according to the General Accounting Office, the cost of the White House vandalism reached about $14,000. The agency said some of the destruction was intentional, including glue smeared on desks, broken furniture, offices full of trash and graffiti in a men's restroom stall that disparaged Bush. There were also missing doorknobs, medallions, and office signs. Is there any question that Hillary will sign away any remaining sovereignty the United States has left to her globalist overlords, acting as the cleanup crew for Obama's two-term facade of a presidency, carrying on the Bush presidency's unyielding New World Order disintegration of the U.S. Constitution? John Bound for InfoWars.com.
Alex Jones here with a message to fellow freedom lovers. The prognosis for the entire planetary economic system runs from bad to worse. The globalist model is to shut down societies and starve patriots out until they acquiesce to the global takeover. That's why we've assembled the most vital and important preparedness items at InfoWarsShop.com. These are items that I did research on, that I personally use. We've got the Life Straw, so you can turn fetid water into safe water anywhere you go. The K-Tor hand crank generator to charge up key equipment during power outages or out in the field. Strategic Relocation, third edition by Joel Skousen. When Disaster Strikes by Matthew Stein. Therosafe, used by Homeland Security to protect yourself during any radiological event. Hand crank shortwave AM/FM radios. Everything that we've researched and found to be the best is available at InfoWarsShop.com, and your purchase makes our InfoWar possible. We're getting prepared. Are you? InfoWarsShop.com.
You all look great. The end of the Republic has never looked better.
It's time to shake the rust off America's foreign policy. No country has ever prospered that failed to put its own interests first.
Shut up! Shut the fuck up!
Our friends and our enemies put their countries above ours. And we, while being fair to them, must start doing the same.
He said that us Mexicans are bringing all types of bad people to this country? That's incorrect, dude.
They're bringing drugs.
We just caught these guys coming across the border. One, two, three, four. They have big satchels.
They're bringing crime. They're rapists. And some, I assume, are good people. We will no longer surrender this country or its people to the false song of globalism. The nation state remains the true foundation for happiness and harmony.
we have kids because we like sex. No, we're having kids ready to start this war. Believe me. I got another one on the way, and she'll be strapped up ready for you. Come get it. Come get it. Come knock on my door and see what happens. We're ready. We're ready.
We're going to build a wall. It's going to be built.
I voted for border security, and some of it was a fence. I don't think we ever called it a wall. Maybe in some places it was a wall.
He is not only a racist. He's not only a misogynist.
Yeah.
He is a fascist.
He is hurting our unity at home.
Why don't you turn your camera? Show them how many people come to these rallies. Turn them. Go ahead, turn them. Go ahead.
Leah McAdoo with InfoWars.com. I am here in West Hollywood, California, and the polls are about 15 seconds from closing. We're still waiting to see, could Bernie Sanders potentially take California, even though they've already called it for Hillary Clinton? The math has made history. The superdelegates have decided tonight. You can see they're counting down. This is the key race here in California, 400 plus delegates to be won here in California. Of course, it's still too early to call, but they've already called it late last night. We're going to go find out from these women. We would just like to know, what does the country have to look forward to with a Hillary Clinton presidency? Hillary Clinton for president, what does the country look like?
If she becomes president, well, first of all, the country looks a lot more united instead of divided. The country looks a lot less racist. The country wakes up the morning she gets in with hope and not fear. She doesn't practice the politics of fear. And I think it's great. What is better than a wonderful, strong, experienced woman?
And so what do you want to say to all the young Bernie supporters out there who have said that they're going to go vote for Trump rather than Hillary Clinton, and they don't like her scandals, they don't like the kind of trail that's sort of following her? How do you talk to those people and make them overlook that?
My name is Robin Tyler. I'm a Democratic Socialist. I produced 3 marches on Washington, major marches with 1 million people. And being a Democratic Socialist and having been an activist since the 60s, I understand their excitement, and I understand their disappointment in not having the candidate get in. But this is not about Bernie Sanders. This is about a movement. I have been in the anti-war movement, the feminist movement, the anti-racism movement. And so what's great about them is, rather than imploding our movement and our Democratic Party, what's great is they can use this, instead of imploding, exploding to be this fantastic movement. And in the next 4 years, this movement, and I'm a Democratic Socialist, this movement will run the country. And I think that's great. And as far as the stuff about Hillary, the right wing has been getting her for 25 years. She's not in jail. She's never been indicted. I respect her for standing by Bill Clinton, although I wouldn't have. So, you know, this sort of misogyny, sexism that comes even from the left. But I'm a Democratic Socialist, I'm a major activist, and I'm for Hillary Clinton.
And here we are, this guy's still out here. There's always one.
And the rock has red glare, the bombs bursting in air, they through the night, all that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave? For the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Thank you.
you, thank you.
All right, everybody. And I think I'm going out of my head.
I'm the boogeyman, everybody.
I'm the boogeyman. That's what I am.
Lieutenant Kissinger on base from the dog park. And the Kissinger on base.
On today, like today, we pass the time of day, a riding love landed in the tent.
That's right, Henry Kissinger on base. It's the Christmas show at the dog park in Bedlam. The first 100 people get the new CD, Henry Kissinger in Sam.
One pill makes you larger,
and the one pill makes you small,
and the one that mother gives me.
I don't have anything at all.
No, ask on us.
Or if you get me tall.
That's right, everybody. I'm the Kissinger on day.
Right, come on, baby, run it by. Now when you get out alive, you get yours, baby, I get mine. We get together all the time. We get together all the time.
Thank you, thank you.
The old get old and the
young get stronger.
They take a week and it may take longer.
They got the guns, but we got the...
This is an excellent time to remind the audience never to take PCP.
Hello! Your ballroom days are over. Night is drawing near.
Shadows of the evening crawl across the year. You walk across the floor with your flower in your hand. Trying to tell me no one.
Once again, if you're just now watching this video, this is a key time to remind the audience never to take PCP. If you're just tuning in and you're just now watching one of these videos for the first time, we are standing outside of the Bernie Sanders rally in Santa Monica, California, at an airport hangar.
Get together one more time.
I'm only kidding. I'm only kidding. Bless you, man. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do